Well, good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. First of all, may I invite our guests with us today. We'd remind everyone sitting in the public gallery or otherwise to turn off electrical devices or turn them to silent so they don't interfere with the work of the committee. First of all, item one is a decision by the committee to take items three and four in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Now, if I might turn to our panel of witnesses today and introduce them from my left to right. First of all, we have Professor Gillian Hogg, who is Deputy Principal External Relations at Heriot-Watt University and is here representing University of Scotland, so welcome today. Next, we have Katie Hutton, who is Director of National Training Programmes, Skills Development Scotland. Again, welcome to you. And then Talat Yaqoob, who is Director of Equate Scotland. Welcome again. Shona Struthers, who is Chief Executive of Colleges Scotland, and Tanya Castell, who is Non-Executive Director and CEO of Changing the Chemistry. So again, welcome to those two guests. And for our panel members, the sound desk will operate the microphone, so if you wish to come in on a question, please simply indicate by raising your hand and I'll seek to bring you in at an appropriate moment. And you don't have to answer every question, but we try to let things flow as the discussion develops. Now, as I think you'll be aware, what we're dealing with is a gender pay gap inquiry. And the remit for the inquiry is to explore the effect of the gender pay gap on the Scottish economy, with a particular focus on business performance, the Scottish public sector, and Scottish government action required to address the issue. So I wonder if I might, just to start off, have one or two comments from a few of you on that, general introductory comments that you would like to make, and then we'll move into questions from committee members. So I'm not sure who would like to start us off on that one. Shona Struthers.
Good morning. In colleges, we have a pay structure which has been reinforced with national bargaining, and it is not based on gender. It's around a fixed pay for a role. So it's irrespective of gender, but what it does mean is that if there is any pay gap, it's down to a relative number of the gender in that pay structure. So it's more likely that if there is a difference, it's because there are men in more senior roles. So if you think about the majority of lower paid staff is female because they work in things like cleaning staff, etc. And the other point to think about in colleges as well is that some of the more senior staff have individual contracts which can then impact on the gender pay gap. I'll leave it at that.
Okay. Anyone else wish to come in? Talat Yaqoob.
So Equate Scotland's working on science, technology, engineering and the built environment, and we come at this from the perspective of the impact of occupational segregation. So we have only 18% women in tech jobs. We have only 2% in construction and 9% in engineering. Women tend to be only 12% of management roles in these areas. So we're looking at a kind of a double ceiling, if you like, of not being in those professions in the first place, not being in those careers, and then not getting to the top. All of our responses from Equate Scotland's perspective has been the impact that can have on the pay gap by tackling this occupational segregation and getting more women into STEM. The Deloitte report that was released last year also indicated that the fastest way to overcome the pay gap is to tackle occupational segregation through tech jobs. So just to highlight that particular perspective that I'm and Equate Scotland are coming at it from.
Perhaps one other contribution at this stage, Tanya Castell.
So Changing the Chemistry comes at it from a slightly different perspective. We are focused on changing the chemistry in the boardroom, so we're trying to improve diversity in the boardroom, but very much from a perspective of making work a fairer place and hopefully changing the environment, because, as already mentioned, you have some structural elements where you have a lot of the women working at the lower level, which increases the gap, by focusing on how to address things such as unconscious bias so that you can get a greater proportion of women at a senior level, then hopefully ultimately the gender pay gap will disappear over time.
Right, thank you. Well, I think we'll now move on to questions, and our first question is from Bill Bowman.
Thank you, Convener. We've been asking the panel the same question. We will hear opinions and comments from you. Do you believe there is a definitive set of statistics in Scotland on women's pay, earnings and employment that we can base basic information on?
Talat, Yaqoob.
So, I think we're all on edge to say something there. I don't think the statistics we have currently are comprehensive enough for us to work from. The statistics that, even this morning when looking at the Scottish Government website, are based on full-time work. That is not a reflection of women's work. They are the vast majority of part-time workers. Within that, we don't have intersectional data. So we don't have data that tells us about women from black minority ethnic backgrounds, disabled, LGBT, immigrant women. We're not able to actually learn about what is happening for women who are likely to be furthest away from opportunity. I think that the data needs to be more comprehensive. I think that the data needs to include part-time work, and I think it needs to be intersectional for it to work for organisations like Equate Scotland who are trying to better the outcomes for women.
Any other comment on that? May I ask one question? Also, does it also depend on statistics about the age of those in different sectors of the workforce in terms of the different positions and those coming in as well?
Absolutely. I would say that is part of intersectional data, would include age and where women are, how long it takes them to get to a senior position in comparison to men as well, what age that takes. I think that would be part of what is our more robust set of data.
Okay.
Then, do you have some sources that are not the Scottish Government that you use?
All of our work is based on Scottish Government data, but it's an appreciation of the fact that we can see that there's gaps here. But of course, we're looking at the Scottish labour market, so it makes most sense for us to use Scottish Government data because we need to be aligned with what it is that the Scottish Government's saying. So it actually prevents us from doing our work as well, because we can only use the data that's available.
Thank you. And I'll move on now to a question from John Mason.
Okay, thanks very much. I hesitate to speak for my female colleagues, but over the years that I've been involved in politics, I get the impression that there's been a kind of change, because I think maybe 20, 25 years ago, there was a kind of thinking that we don't want quotas and targets and all of that kind of stuff, because we'd rather just everybody came through on their merits, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But kind of because we've made so little progress, I think I'm convinced now, and I think a lot of other people seem to be, that we do need quotas and targets. So I'm interested in your feelings. Do quotas and targets work? And are they necessary? Are they desirable? Where are we going with that?
Tanya Castell and then Shona Struthers.
So from my perspective, thinking about the board level, certainly we do support quotas. You're right, you would like to think that they shouldn't be necessary, but if you look at the data around unconscious bias and how bias impacts all the decisions we make, regardless of gender, you might have heard the example of in orchestras where they introduced blind auditions and the success rate of women, and it wasn't actually about women, they did it because they were worried that too many musicians were coming from certain teachers, and the success rate of women went up 50% at first audition and 300% at final audition. There's also research done by Harvard around private equity, so doing Dragon's Den type pitches, where the same pitch, all you've got is a video and a different voice, a male voice or a female voice, men were just slightly more than twice as successful at pitching for the same pitch. So to my mind, to overcome the biases for a short time, I think we need targets. My view, they shouldn't be there long term. Once you've overcome those biases, hopefully you can get closer to being a true meritocracy, in which case they should go away. But I think we need them until people get more used to that mix.
And I would add to that, I think if you look at anything that you want to improve, you never really improve anything unless you set yourself a target. And you monitor it and you measure it, And while we might think that you shouldn't have to do that, I think you absolutely do. So I would cite two examples that are currently happening within the college sector. There's the college sector is signing up to the gender pledge, the 50-50 board members by 2020. I personally have been a board member. I wouldn't like to think I was on that board just because I was female. But the reality is, I think you need the target to make you aware of it. It's about raising awareness. And then I'd like to think that if a woman was successful, it was because of skills, talent, experience as well. So that's one thing. And then I think the other thing I'd like to cite to you, where again we're measuring, is in the college sector, we have the Gender Action Plan, which is a huge initiative that's been started by the Funding Council that goes across colleges and universities. I'm sure my colleague will pick this up. And in there, again, it's about raising awareness, but it's a deliberate policy to set targets that we can measure. It's about closing the gap where there's some of the courses like care, for example, there's 4% of men are in care courses, and in engineering, 4% of women are in engineering, so huge gaps. And I think the only way you close those gaps is raising the awareness of the gap and setting a target to try and meet. So there's a target set by the Funding Council to close the gap to at least, 75%, so reducing that huge gap to less of a gap. But I'm a great believer that you do need to put these targets in place if you really are going to try and change anything.
Katie Hutton.
I think targets can be useful. I think what you've also got to think about then is the time scale for them, for instance, and also maybe consequences of them. So, for instance, if you look at occupational segregation, and like the Funding Council and the colleges, we've got an Equalities Action Plan for modern apprenticeships. And apprenticeships are reflective of occupational segregation. They are a job with training, so they do reflect that. That doesn't mean you don't do anything. You actually try and affect it. And I think your previous witnesses have gone on about the sort of complex forces that are at play here in terms of how we end up with the workforce that we do. Part of it is about the systemic nature, about societal attitudes, etc. So to affect what's happening in the workplace, you have to start early on. So it takes time to see that coming through then in terms of change in the workplace, starting from primary school. So again, if you're looking at targets, I think you should look at how long does it take for something that has to happen early on, so that attitudes aren't, attitudes can change, etc., to then what happens within the workplace. And I think also the consequences. So, for instance, if you set quotas for specific places, etc., then you have to accept that if individuals, because their attitudes haven't changed, etc., don't come forward to those places, then those places are going to be unfilled. So I think I'm saying that targets can be good, but you just got to think about it, the practical consequences of it, and also sometimes the time scales.
Professor Hogg.
I think in the university sector, we're very aware of the fact that it goes back into schools. So yes, we want to close the gap, but if girls aren't taking physics in school, they can't apply for physics at university. So you have to look at it across the piece as to right throughout the educational timeline. How do we encourage more girls into the kind of subjects that will lead to STEM at university? But also, I think we're very aware of the fact that male representation at university is falling. So over the past few years, we've had 40% of males approximately and 60% of women coming to university, but they are then going into gendered subjects when they're at university. So very few women take computer science, very few boys take psychology. So it's quite a complicated picture. It's not just one target. It's a target within subjects as well.
Well, I mean, that leads me on. Clearly, Tanya Castell's saying set targets for the board. But I mean, some of your answers are making me think we should set targets for physics class and set S5, so we should have equal numbers of boys and girls in the physics class. I mean, that would be the way to force it through, would it not?
I don't know whether you can actually force people to take physics or maths at school. I think it's more of about the culture within the education system that encourages getting away from gendered subjects. And we know that the number of boys taking languages is falling. Whereas, obviously, you can't come to university to study languages if you haven't got a higher in languages. So it's about a culture throughout the education system, I think, rather than saying, we'll set a quota at university if we don't have a pipeline to for people coming through.
Okay. There's nothing to add. Yeah, who wants to come in?
So quotas and targets work. They've been shown to work, particularly at board level, and leadership roles. So from Equate Scotland's perspective, yes, they work. There's evidence right across Europe to show us that it works. But quotas and targets work when it's an evidence base and there is a, essentially an action plan as to how you can stop using them in the future, so that it is changing culture and changing attitudes. So at the moment, we only have, at SEQF level 6 and 7, we only have 23% of the pupils are girls. If we were to set a quota of 50%, without doing attitudinal change, without tackling gender stereotyping and having training for teachers and parents even, and starting at that early age of what subjects are wanted to be taken, those quotas or targets would not only prove to be ineffective, but there might be hostility towards them. So there has to be an approach that is holistic. And I don't think an approach on quotas in primary and secondary schools where there isn't an evidence base to say where they've been successful is necessarily the correct approach. Where we have boardroom targets, that's been proven across Europe to create change. What I would suggest is that there needs to be a lot more investment in cultural and attitudinal change across from early years right the way through into at the end of secondary school and when university choices are being made.
Okay, thanks. I'll leave it at that.
Well, perhaps I could just follow up one or two points, because I think it was touched on by Professor Hogg. My understanding is in the university sector there's a difficulty now because roughly 62% female students, 42% male, and that's an issue that the Scottish Funding Council has asked the universities to address going forward in regard to two things. One is the male-female imbalance, and also the issue of specific subjects. And the suggestion, I think, from the Scottish Funding Council has been that there should be no more than a 75-25 in any subject by a certain date. The colleges sector, the overall picture, I think, is roughly representative of what we see in the population. I think slightly more female students than male, but not a lot, so roughly reflecting the population. And then apprenticeships, we have a different, perhaps the opposite to the university, or even more pronounced gender imbalance. Now, what I want to ask for your comments on, the universities, that was an issue that was certainly focused on for a while to change the balance, but now it's gone to the opposite, in the opposite direction. If we look at apprenticeships, there's still the problem. I mean, if girls, for example, do better academically than boys at school, it might seem to some people logically they're likely to go to university. If the places at university are filled by female students, the male pupils may then end up in apprenticeships, things like that. So I'm just wondering, the suggestion has been that quotas may work, and I'm just wondering whether that is borne out by the evidence of what has happened in the university sector over the last few years, or whether or not sometimes by trying to do these things, we imbalance things further, or in fact create a new problem. So is there an overall strategy that can be adopted right across the three sectors that I've mentioned to try and ensure that we don't run into imbalances which were perhaps not intended in the first place, but then may have consequences or effects now that were unintended? I don't know who would like to. Yes, Shona Struthers.
Thank you. I mean, I think some of the panel have already raised this. I think it's actually wider than just looking at apprenticeships and colleges and universities. It's got to be well before that. You have to be looking at a cultural change that goes right back into early years. In fact, goes into the family home. So it's much, much wider. I think if you just try and say, how can we shift the balance between apprenticeships, colleges and universities, then I think we're missing a trick. I mean, you're talking about societal, cultural change, and it has to be embedded. And I know, for example, in the college sector, we do have our gender action plan, and there's some fantastic bits of work that go on in there. But that has to be across all institutions, parliament, businesses, families, and I think there's certain elements of that, so it has to be sustained, it has to be resourced, It has to be about raising awareness. It has to be about having role models. So there's lots of different elements that we can share. There's loads of information that we can share, but it has to be across the piece. And I think if we just look at not include the full education spectrum, for example, then I think we will not be successful, and we could well then create imbalances that we don't quite understand how they've been created because we were trying to do something else.
And also perhaps throwing in the question of individual choice into the mix. People do choose to do certain things. Just wondering, now, Katie Hutton wanted to come in, and then Talat Yaqoob.
Yeah, I think sometimes when you look at the outputs of an education system and also what's happening in the workplace generally, looking at the symptoms, not necessarily part of the cause, and it is about societal attitudes. One of the big projects we've invested in over the last couple of years to try and create this pipeline towards apprenticeships and also non-gender choice within FE&HE is around working with the Institute of Physics. And what we did there is it's about a whole school approach to looking at gender balance, and it's about both influencing the kids at school but also influencing the influencers, and that's the parents, the teachers, etc., and looking at unconscious bias that's going on in terms of how lessons are taught, looking at the curriculum, etc. We allied that deliberately to the Education Scotland 6 STEM cluster areas, because what we wanted to do was see this be sustained and also disseminated, working with the inspectorate to make sure that we could learn the lessons from that. And what we've done as a result of that, and it's in second of its third year, is use the resources from that, and Education Scotland are now going to disseminate that across Scotland. So I think that's got a better potential of being anchored within the school system because you've allied it to the work that Education Scotland are doing. But there is all these other influences that go on, and that is what you're fighting against all the time. And so a holistic approach, yes, but it is difficult.
Now, Talat Yaqoob wanted to come in.
I think what we're talking about is either having the status quo or quotas, and I don't think we're talking about what actually happens in the middle. So I think there's right places for quotas to exist. I think there's evidence to say that targets can exist right across the pipeline, because I think what Shona said about having something to aspire to creates change and creates a strategy. I think that's important. But there doesn't need to be, there's space in between and good practice examples of positive action measures that are being taken by a range of different education institutes, particularly in the college sector. So we work with City of Glasgow College, and they have pioneered a Women into Construction HNC and a Women into Engineering, and it's all women for the first year, and then they move into a mixed group. But the idea for that is to have a safe space to be able to pursue a subject that you perhaps were stereotyped into not taking, and that has been proven to be really successful, and it's oversubscribed. So there's clearly appetite for women to be in these subjects if we are innovative in the approach that we take to get them there in the first place. Now, City of Glasgow College is an example of a college that has put targets in because they want to have a certain number of women in their mainstream engineering subjects. But the innovative approach was to have this first year, which was based on positive action and for women only. So targets work, and there are innovative ways to pursue them that I think we need to be reflecting on a little bit more. There's a little bit of a reluctance to pursue positive action measures, despite them being evidenced and legal and the right way to go. And what I would love to see out of this particular out of this committee is an encouragement to pursue positive action measures and case studies into how that can happen.
Jackie Bailey want to come in with a question.
Just very quickly, because it's relevant to what's been discussed. I'm fortunate to have a STEM hub at St Patrick's Primary School in Dumbarton in collaboration with the Glasgow Science Centre. And I went there, and it was just tremendous to see all these young people, P2s, engaged in science activity. So much so that there's interest from the parents, and the parents will be going in of an evening. So I wondered, is that the right age and stage to actually capture them, or do we actually even need to do something with pre-fives as well?
Tanya Castell.
I mean, my view would be certainly the younger you can start. I mean, there was some recent research published saying that even between the age of 5 and 6, girls already start thinking of themselves as not as brilliant as boys. And that boys, it was some research done in the States, but it was a 5-year-old girl and a 5-year-old boy, they see themselves about the same. You get to 6, they're already absorbing stereotypes. And I think, you know, I meet lots of very able board members and they say, oh, it's, you know, they're very aware that they want the right person for the job, and I totally support that. But I meet so many people who are not aware of unconscious bias and not realizing that they think they're recruiting the right person, but not necessarily so. So I think the sooner we can start trying to address that, what's being referred to as a cultural issue, at the stereotyping and the biases develop from a very, very young age.
Katie Hutton.
Absolutely, the younger the better, and I can use my own example. My daughter went to a nursery school, and when they were passing out of the nursery school, as we do these days, having graduation ceremonies, they were asked, I said to her, what are you going to say, what job do you want to do when you grow up? And I was giving her ideas, and she said, no, that's a boy's job. And that just showed you, even from so young people, and we had not bought her dolls or anything like that, you know, there was just no, but it's around us.
Ash Denham.
I was just going to ask on the back of this idea of the fact that we need to do better at getting girls into choosing STEM subjects, and we're talking about, you know, at the younger ages. Is there any other countries, or how are other countries doing on this subject? Is there some examples internationally that we can look for good practice on this?
Yes, there's. I mean, the statistics that we have in Scotland and the UK are one of the worst in Europe, I'm afraid. We are making progress, particularly in engineering, in civil engineering. However, we are behind Cyprus, Croatia, Egypt, India, Turkey. And there's a whole lot of evidence that I'm afraid I don't have with me, but I would be very happy to provide to the committee as to what is going on there and what the difference is. But what you will find is that there is a cultural and attitudinal difference towards the value of certain jobs. Mm-hmm. So where we have, to be perfectly honest, a lot of imagery about engineering and construction is a white older man in a hard hat, mm-hmm. which is about 1% of what engineering is actually about. Yeah. It's creativity, it's artistic, it's changing everything around us. And there is an appreciation for that depth of engineering in those other countries. So it is an entire cultural change about how we value those jobs and what we think of those jobs, and them coming a lot closer to mainstream and an appreciation of the engineering that goes into everything that we do, and the artistic, creative side of it. So happy to provide that to the committee, and I can provide international statistics as well. But what you'll find is attitudinal difference towards the STEM subjects, which is... there's not one silver bullet that I can say that they're doing that we're not doing, I'm afraid.
Shona Struthers wanted to come in.
I just wanted to slightly widen it to say that it's not always about stereotyping for female or women. There's also the care sector, which is very much like we need to encourage men to join that. So I wouldn't want us to leave this morning thinking this is all about trying to get women into STEM. It's actually much wider. There are bias on both genders, and then a further point would be it isn't just gender, it's actually much wider characteristics as well we should be thinking about. So I'm sure there'll be questions from the committee on that.
Okay, we'll move on now to question from, I think, Jackie Bailey.
Very much, convener. Can I just observe how welcome it is to have an all-woman panel?
I'm sorry.
I don't think we've had one yet, but that certainly is welcome. You'll all be aware that we're soon to have legislation on the pay gap and pay gap reporting. Do you actually believe that's going to make any difference to reducing the pay gap?
I think it's a start. I mean, I think in some of the boards that I'm on, you can see that people are having to think about why it looks the way it does. And I think just by having data helps. You know, it makes it easier to set targets, and it just makes it much more transparent. You know, there's been a coming from where we're looking at it at the board level, having data helps. Although actually, I get very cross because everyone says, oh, well, you know, women say have got 25% of boards. No, they've got 25% of the FTSE 100, which is just 100 companies in the whole of the UK. So I think... you know, having that data so that you can look at it more carefully and then understand it, I think is a step forward. You again got to address some of these structural issues where, you know, why are people in the jobs they are, and again, how can you? One of the reasons changing the chemistry is very keen on making boards more diverse is that hopefully you make the workplace a place that works for everybody, and therefore you get more diversity throughout it, not just at lower levels, which tends to happen today.
Professor Hogg wanted to.
The universities have had to publish their equal pay data for a few years now, and it is very interesting. It is perhaps a feature of what gets measured, gets managed, but it does, I think, highlight very starkly where our pay gap is. I think, like a lot of universities, we actually have quite a dramatic pay gap because we, not within grade, but across a structural pay gap. Across our grades, universities have some very highly paid academics and they have cleaners and housekeepers. So we do have that starkness of that. And I think universities, by having to publish that, have started to work on it quite systematically. And I think that's been important. I mean, I think sometimes it's the language as well that you realise that you're using. So, for example, we have in the university housekeepers and they're all women. If you called them building managers, would more men apply for those jobs? So you start thinking about the language that you use and how, what your culture is within the university. So I personally find publishing the equal pay data has been important.
Can I just follow that up? Because obviously this applies to companies with 250 employees or more. And Scotland, as we know, is typically an SME-driven economy. So I'm wondering whether you think this should actually be extended, and if it should, what do you think the threshold should be?
I think it should be extended, and I think it should be something that is part and parcel of being an employer. So if you're an employer, publish your pay gap so that you know that this is something that you have to work on. I'm not entirely sure why the threshold is there. At the end of the day, we're trying to create fair workplaces. So whether you have 5 or 250, both of those workplaces should be fair and equal. So I think that's something that we need to consider. But I also think it's the reality here is that the publication, whilst publishing pay gaps are welcome, they're not going to create radical change in the existence of the pay gap when it is such a culturally entrenched and complex issue. I also think it's important that we have some level of balances and checks in place as to what exactly is being reported, how that data is being collected, and along with a pay gap, a strategy on how you're going to do something about it.
Yes, Professor Hogg.
This is not my area of expertise, but I'm aware of the fact that when you're talking about a pay gap, particularly in small companies, you're really talking about reward more generally. And if you have very small companies, how individuals are rewarded, it's not necessarily just on the hourly rate. So I think if you are going to go to small companies, you need to think about the broader context in which that company operates.
Andy Whiteman had a follow-up and then more.
Yes, thank you. Convener, just to follow up Jackie Bailey's question, we heard evidence last week our witness, Anna Ritchie-Allen, who was attending employer briefings that are organised by lawyers, was talking about widespread tuition to find loopholes where, for example, a company can be divided up so that the partners are not included in the gender pay gap. Have you got any evidence of that kind of activity?
I know that Tanya Castell wanted to come in, but perhaps that's in the previous point, although you're welcome to come in on this question. Otherwise, Talat, Yaqoob, or sorry, Tanya.
I mean, I can certainly say that, not that they're trying to evade it, but they are slightly, maybe in some places, taken aback by what the data looks like, partly potentially from the structure of the organisation in terms of, say, if you've got a small company that grows and, you know, it's established by a key number of partners, that, you know, back then would have been male, you clearly, so the data can look terrible. So I think it's just giving them a bit of a shock. But I haven't come across anyone actually trying to get through loopholes. I think you know, in terms of going to smaller companies, that the bit I was just going to add was, I think, maybe not the tiny companies, but I find that with a lot of the people I talk to about the benefits of diversity, there's still a lot of people who think maybe it's only about being fair, and actually they don't necessarily totally appreciate the economic benefit or the diverse teams perform better. So I think by bringing it a bit further down, you help get that message there. Again, you'd have to address that cultural point of people understanding, yes, there's a fair piece, but actually you'll get better results, so there's a benefit to Scotland as a whole.
I think Talat Yaqoob wanted to come.
Given the fact that we work so closely with employers, I don't think any employer is going to put their hand up and tell us that that's what they're doing. So I can't give you a case in point of that happening. But yes, that is what we've heard anecdotally, and Anna's right to point out. I think that's what I was getting at when I politely said checks and balances in how it's reported and where the data's coming from and how it's collected. Just asking employers to publish their pay gap, whilst they all might be doing it differently, doesn't create any kind of coherence and doesn't actually benefit the cause at all.
And Shona Struthers.
Thank you. I would also just like to add, it's sometimes it's more than just pay. I'm thinking about working practices. So if you have perhaps an array of flexible working practices, that can often help tackle gender imbalance as well. So if you don't, for example, allow part-time working or flexible working or flexi-time, then those things can also impact. So it's wider, I think, than just a pay gender gap.
Right. Now, I had inadvertently passed over Richard Leonard, who had some questions to ask, I think, relating to public boards. So my apologies to Richard Leonard, and perhaps you could come in at this stage.
Yes, I accept your apology, convener. I just want to look at the public sector, the role of Scottish Government and public agencies. And I'm going to look at a specific example, but I think it maybe draws out some general points. And I'm looking at Katie Hutton because it relates to the Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Board structure, which is, again, at the root, to some extent, of the whole debate about occupational segregation and apprenticeships is one of the areas where we need, I think, there's general agreement on, we need to do more work to try to diversify the channels, the jobs, the occupations, the apprenticeships that young people go down. But when I was checking fairly recently, and I looked at the composition of those people who populate the advisory boards, when I looked at the Employer Equalities Advisory Group, 70% of those were women. But when I look at the main advisory board, which is the principal vehicle for advising Skills Development Scotland and the Scottish Government, it turns out that it's the complete opposite. In fact, it's worse. Nearly 80% of the composition of the main advisory board are men, and just 19-20% are women. Doesn't that tell us something a little bit about where we're missing the target as far as representation, quotas, targets, getting our resources and our brains in the right place?
I would disagree with you that the SAB as it stands is a collective sum of its parts. Every bit of it is as important, to be honest, because we see those bits about frameworks and standards and equalities and employer engagement being there. To a certain extent, I think you're right on the gender balance of the advisory board, which is kind of reflective also because deliberately targeted CEOs to try and get employers to take a real interest in driving apprenticeships forward, because we always talk about being employer-led and it's important to be there. It's something we set it up, and it was also a function of who said they would come on it as well, because clearly CEOs and chief financial officers as well are clearly busy. I think even in the qualities advisory group, the qualities part of it, we've also recognised that we have to, now that it's been set up and running, maybe we have to look at who else we need to bring on to these groups as well. So, I mean, that's certainly something that we're alive to and we should be doing something about.
I mean, I don't know whether any of the other witnesses have got views in a more general sense about how it seems to be, and it's certainly my experience, that if it's an equalities issue, there'll be a probably more than disproportionate representation of women on it. But when it comes to some of the main decision bodies, that's where the deficit exists. Is that people's general experience?
Well, I can quote you some statistics from the college sector. In terms of our board gender split, we're actually 60-40, so not a bad gender split on boards. And that, and when you take that through into senior management teams, it's actually the other way around. So I think in the college sector we seem to have quite a fair balance. However, I could draw your attention to the chairs of college boards, and when you look at that, there is a disproportionate number of males to females in the chair position. So that, for me, it's an observation more than anything. But if you think of our regional chairs and colleges being publicly appointed, this is something that's within the mandate of the public appointments process. So. And there we've got a 23% female to the rest being male in regional chair public appointments. So it's not particularly representative of the sector as a whole, because actually the gender balance is good there.
And who makes those appointments? Sorry.
The regional chairs are publicly appointed.
By the Scottish Government. Thank you. Tanya Castell.
I mean, I think there is, in terms of your question, there is certainly on a lot of diversity events, one recently with Scottish Government, Scottish Enterprise, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, you do get more women, a majority of women versus men. So there is still something about how you engage men. Clearly, obviously, there are a lot of men here. I hope I'm not offending anyone. But I think there is something about quite a lot of people get men turned off by the diversity piece, which for me is why it's so important to promote the benefits to business or organisations. It's not just commercial businesses, that you do have those different perspectives and therefore you do get better performance. I mean, I think the Scottish Government Public Appointments team have done an amazing job in terms of improving on gender diversity, what they've done. Changing the chemistry, I should say, has been working with them, so possibly slightly biased, but and it has definitely been improving, and I can say I'm on a public sector board and we're 50-50, so in Scotland.
Right, thank you. Now we'll move to a question from Ash Denham.
Thank you. My question was around occupational segregation, which I know we've covered in parts of your answers already. So clearly we need to do more at different levels. So apprenticeships, we've touched on that a little bit, further education, higher education. And Talat, I think it was you that mentioned, you know, the idea of positive action measures, that they work, that there's case studies, and women in construction, that course, was that a further education course that you mentioned already? So could you give us some more examples of other positive action measures, maybe at these different levels, that's things that we could be looking into that, you know, we have evidence that they do work?
There's an opportunity for me to plug Scottish Equate Scotland's recent report, Rising to the Challenge. It's filled with case studies specifically on positive action. We, Equate Scotland, the vast majority of our work is trying to get employers to take positive action measures. One example of this is our CareerWise project, which is a women-only placement, paid placement in industry for third and fourth year graduate undergraduate students. Mm-hmm. We have in a year around 40 placements, we will have up to 300 young women apply. There is demand there. Positive. It's just another example of positive action working. Every year we've had more employers take part, and it's in year three now. So it's working, but it's about getting employers to recognise that positive action doesn't need to be frightening. You can get support in it, and it is perfectly legal. There is a misunderstanding between positive action and positive discrimination, which we need to overcome, because it's preventing employers from taking part. So the CareerWise project, that includes set of organisations, Computer Application Services, which is a Scottish SME, for example, and we can provide you and the committee with a whole range of case studies on that. There's also West Lothian College is doing something similar to the City of Glasgow College, which is about getting women into engineering. They're the two kind of positive action examples that I can give, and I know that is being pursued even more with the Gender Action Plan as well. There's also other small positive action measures that can be taken about, and it's what Professor Hogg referred to, about changing language. So for example, for a case study that we were putting together for the tech sector, job descriptions that looking at indeed.com, putting in technology and putting in the word aggressive gave me 9,500 jobs to choose from. Looking at the word dominant gave me just over 2,000 jobs. So having conversations with employers about how they market themselves and what language they're using is fundamental to creating that change. But just on occupational segregation, it's also really important that despite being a STEM organisation, but being a feminist, the other part of this is the undervaluing of the work where women are now. So in care, in social care, in teaching, in cleaning, in administrative services, where women are is undervalued. So whilst we're trying to get women into STEM, there also needs to be equal push to value the work on the other side. Otherwise, why would men pursue those jobs? And how can we then value the women who are there and overcome the pretty significant occupational segregation?
Examples across the universities in Scotland of how the universities are working with schools, some really good examples of trying to encourage more girls to take STEM subjects. But I agree with Talat, we have to look across the piece at all of the way that we view particular roles.
And Shona Struthers.
The college sector, I mean, we've heard some of them this month. There's some amazing examples, and I've got loads of examples here. I'm willing just to share them with you rather than go into any detail, but there's loads of examples, and I can quote things like, you know, This Girl Can is an initiative to show what women can do. There's This Man Cares, which is to try and encourage men, and Man in the Mirror, which is around trying to encourage men into, like, beauty and... those types of careers. So, but again, I think someone mentioned that the schools. You know, it does go right across the schools. There's loads of initiatives. There was the Energy Skills Partnership did a great piece of work with the Bloodtown Challenge. I don't know if you're aware of that, which was to encourage school children. It was about you had to make a rocket car and then race it, and that was really evenly balanced between boys and girls. So I think there's a plethora of examples of great work going on, and I suppose it's how do you take all of that and build it in and make it sustainable and make it, you know, resource it. You absolutely have to resource this, so it's not a fad. It's got to be built into the way that things are run normally. Otherwise, things just come and go.
I'm also interested in this idea, you know, expressed as if you can't see it, you can't be it, or something worse to that effect. And recently I visited the bio quarter, and I was talking to Edinburgh University, and they were doing an outreach project to a local school in my constituency. And they'd asked some of the school children to come in, and they'd talk to them around the lab and so on. And then one of the girls asked if she could come in over the summer and do a kind of a work experience thing. And so I met her, and she said to me, I thought I was going to become a hairdresser, but now I've been in the lab, I'm going to be a scientist. And I just thought, wow, that's really amazing. So that's quite a change. And so, and this ties into what you were saying about engineering, that people don't understand what engineering is, what's involved in it. Are we missing something at the careers advice stage where we're not explaining to kids, to girls, to boys, what these jobs are and how it might match up with their skills? Is there something more we could be doing there?
Katie Hutton first.
I mean, we're responsible for the careers guidance service in schools, and we've done a lot with our own staff around unconscious bias things as well. And to be honest, I mean, you will see your careers guidance member of staff, but you've got your guidance teacher, you see more of your teachers. I think it has to be wider than that we talked about, this holistic school approach. And I think in terms of trying to anchor everything, the way that Shona said about making sure it's systemic within the school system and even down to nursery, you have to think about the levers that are there in terms of, you know, how is a school inspected? I know that Education Scotland have looked at equality as an aspect within the inspection service as well. You've got to look at how the curriculum is delivered and developed, and how that, what does that do about engendering particular attitudes, etc. So I think you've got to look at all your levers, as well as the specific careers guidance inputs, but also what's there in terms of what, how things are delivered in the school system and out with.
Talat, Yaqoob.
I think there's been improvements in careers advice over the years. I don't think it's where we would want it to be. We hear a lot of anecdotal evidence
of the careers advice that students were given when they're in their first year of university, and how they were told, are you sure engineering is what you want to pursue? It'll be really difficult if you're only one of two girls in the room. Now, I think really, if we are looking to get more women into STEM, we need to have a focus on saying, yes, you can do this. We'd like to support you to do this. Here are support systems when you get into university and college, not just to get you there, but keep you there right the way through to the end, because retention is an issue as well. So I think there's definite improvements that can be made when it comes to challenging gender stereotyping within the school setting, but also with parents. And so those attitudes are challenged and changed at school and then reinforced at home. I'm not sure where the child is meant to go if they're getting conflicting messages. So there needs to be a real holistic approach to this. And I think a few examples of people doing it right, EDF and Shell are examples who have done girl-only outreach in schools and invited them in to do site visits, and it's only for girls, and they do development activities, another example of positive action. And yes, what we see are more girls getting rid of the myth of what actually being an engineer is and then pursuing those subjects. So it works, but we need more of it.
Okay. Professor Hogg.
Yeah, I was just going to mention that there was a 2014, so it's not that recent, Institute of Engineering and Technology study, which identified that only 1% of parents would encourage their daughters to be engineers. So we have got to think about the whole environment that girls are being brought up in. I think also you tend to find that girls apply for university courses that they recognise from school. So if we're not teaching engineering as such in schools, then they don't apply for engineering. They apply for something that they recognise, leaving medicine and law aside, obviously. But if you're studying business management in school, I'll go and study business management at university. Okay. So how people perceive what engineers are is very important.
Just to just linking into that, there's a great example at Fife College of changing of the titles of HNCs and HNDs to include the words creativity and art, and they've had an increase in the number of young women who apply. So having something that says technology or software design rather than software development. And it's words that are that feel more approachable and that are recognised in the work that you've done in school means that you're more likely to apply in the same way. Job adverts work in the same way. So a Fife College is a really good example of them looking at the prospectus and changing the language so that it feels more accessible and welcoming to young women.
Right. May I just ask something? We've talked a lot about going in at a young age and so forth, but and I think protective characteristics were mentioned. One of the ones that wasn't was age, and I'm just wondering how that fits into the whole picture, because, of course, people at later stages in their careers, or indeed young people, may choose to go into a particular course, start work in that, decide it's not actually for them, because I'm just wondering how that fits into this picture, people's changing choices or changing understanding of what they might have thought they wanted to do, and then later, later in life, career changes, or how age fits into this. I don't know who would like to comment. Shona Struthers.
Thank you. I mean, the college sector, although predominantly focusing on young people, it is actually encouraging for the adult learner and specifically women returners. It's one of the only avenues that can encourage women back into the workforce, for example. I recall we used to have, back in the day, women's technology centres. Don't know if anybody's aware of them. I personally served on one of the boards of a women's technology centre, and what they did was encourage women from regeneration areas who had no qualifications at all and actually didn't have the confidence to go to college or anything. So we're making an assumption that women returners will actually go to college. So there are some groups that you need to reach that are harder to. So I don't think there's any women's technology centres left anymore, which is a real shame, but they did low-level qualifications and just got people back into studying. They either went on and studied more and got further qualifications, or they joined the workforce. But certainly the college sector is an avenue to encourage returners and adult learners and to reskill and upskill, because often if you get made redundant in your 40s or 50s, sometimes there are no obvious avenues where to go. So I think keeping the college sector open and available to the adult learner and not just for young people is absolutely vital.
Thank you. And Talat, Yaqoob.
Just following on from that, I think colleges are a space where that happens now and we can take a lot of good practice from. The City of Glasgow College Women into Engineering, HNC, whilst there are 18-year-olds, young women who are 18, there's also women who are 40, 50, having a career change there. So I think there's a good examples that we can take from that. I do think there needs to be a focus on young people coming in, but if we go to what Ash Denham said about what you can't be what you can't see, if you don't have women role models, then you are less likely to stick around. So an example of the work that Equate Scotland's doing is a Women Returners programme, which is to get women who were in the sector in STEM but left for a variety of reasons, whether they found the environment hostile, whether they couldn't go back with caring responsibilities. We are doing paid placements with employers to get them back into work and get them contributing to the STEM sector once again. And I think it's vital that we take a whole pipeline approach and that it's not us, you know, 16 to 21 or early years, but it actually needs to be interventions right across the pipeline over a period of time for there to be any demonstrable change.
Thank you. And Gillian Martin.
I just have a very short supplementary to that about apprenticeships. I mean, apprenticeships have not been doing as well as they could be in attracting women into apprenticeships, but also this, what we've just been talking about older women returners, there's surely an open goal there about getting this whole, the thoughts about apprenticeships, but not just being for young people, but for being older people too.
Yeah, I mean, to cover the kind of thing about they've not been as successful as they could be, they do reflect, they are a job with training, so they are reflective of what's happening out there in the world of employment. And also you've got to remember that apprenticeships also in terms of how it's funded is prioritised against particular sectors and for economic reasons, which are also, some of those sectors are ones that traditionally boys will do, like engineering, we'll say construction. It does follow what jobs are also available. So, and also what we said about what happens earlier, if you know, less girls will apply for engineering, less girls will apply for construction, and because of the attitudes that are formed much earlier down. So that's why we've published our Equalities Action Plan, and we've undertaken a lot of work. We worked with Equate, we funded Ayrshire Girl Can, you know, with Ayrshire College and with colleges to try and stimulate a lot of activity from the school system, working with Education Scotland and partners, and we do think that other educational partners need to keep taking that work on. But also around last week, you'll have seen in thanks to everybody that participated in Scottish Apprenticeship Week. It was much appreciated. But those iconic images of girls that you would have seen in Waverley and Central Station, trying to break down those images about, girls can only do this, the five C's that they call them, in terms of caring, cashiering and all that sort of stuff, but also trying to break those moulds. I think in terms of age as well, the funding out of all our starts, about 20% is targeted towards older age groups, and it's targeted on engineering, those kind of occupations. So therefore, again, you've got the same issue. So it's symptomatic, I think, of the labour market. It's symptomatic of the attitudes that are formed, and that's why you have the figures that you do at the moment. And unless those things have got to change, and that's why we're working with a range of partners to try and address what the underlying issues are.
Dean Lockhart.
Thank you. Just following up on the different age groups and the pay gap within different age groups, some recent data we've looked at indicates that in Scotland, the pay gap disappears for women in the age bracket between 30 and 39. In fact, there's a positive gap of 0.4%. Just wanted to get the panel's view on, is that something you recognise in terms of the data you've looked at, or anecdotally, is that something you've come across? Because it's the only age group within which there is a positive pay gap, because after the age of 30, 39, the negative wage gap reappears in Scotland to be 8.8%. So just wanted to get your views on, is this something you recognise? And if it is, what you think the reasons are for this apparent spike in equality at this age level, and then fall away after the age of 39? Thank you.
Who would like to try that one?
I mean, for me, it would have to just be anecdotal, which is around maybe women returners and it being flexible working patterns that just perhaps aren't there, and it just doesn't encourage people to come back in at the same level in the workplace. But it's purely anecdotal.
Right, no other takers on that one. All right. We'll move then on to a question from Gordon MacDonald.
Just a very quick point to go back on in relation to STEM subjects. There's been a couple of comments I've picked up that we need to deal with the attitude problem and get people at a young age, and we need role models. So my question is, the majority of nursery teachers are female. The majority of primary school teachers are female. The secondary school teachers are about 50-50. So, you know, is it a cultural issue, or is it an issue that because the people that are teaching our youngsters haven't actually raised their horizons or dealt with the problem because it's not a priority? I mean, how do you deal with it when the role model is female throughout most of their education?
Talat, Yaqoob.
I think having role models who are nursery teachers, teachers in primary and secondary school, majority being female, is a cultural problem. I don't think those can be separated out. I think a cultural problem of women being more likely to be pursuing jobs that are about care, that are involved children, that's naturally there's going to be, the consequence of that is going to be more women in those roles. And if you ask children, you know, who looks after you, and they will refer to women. They will refer to the women around them. I think this comes back to the point that I was making about whilst we are working on, and rightly, focusing on, for the sake of economic growth, on STEM, we can't ignore the other side where there is a disproportionate number of women in care or teaching or in, at nursery level. So I think what we should be doing is elevating those careers, valuing women's work, and similarly to the way that the Gender Action Plan is working, getting men into those roles and taking on a level of care responsibility and being involved in caring, whether it's teaching or actually as parents doing more caring, is, I think, fundamental to tackling the occupational segregation.
Some of the written evidence we received said females whose degree subjects had been in mathematics or science earned more than their male counterparts. This points to the importance of encouraging girls to study subjects such as maths and science at school and university. So are we saying that the teachers themselves are not doing enough signposting? Or is it not their role?
I think it is their role. I think it's absolutely their role to do more signposting. I think they need to be supported to do that. So I think before we point our fingers at teachers to say you need to do more, I think we need to support them to be able to do that in the first place. So whether that means training, tackling unconscious bias, whether that is working with careers guidance, whether that is taking a more strategic approach and a whole school approach. But I think teachers can only do that if they're supported to do that. They have the training and the backing to enable them to do that.
Katie Hutton and then Shona Struthers.
I would agree with that, and that's the whole purpose of the improving gender balance approach that we're taking with the schools, and it really is about supporting them to challenge their own assumptions, to challenge that unconscious bias. Also, you mentioned nursery care. One of the things we challenge around looking at the numbers in terms of childcare, looking at who's involved in that in terms of the jobs that are there and apprenticeships. And one of the barriers that there is also the cultural attitudes of parents who sometimes aren't happy about a man working with young children as well. So it's part of just that whole wider cultural thing that I think we've all talked about today.
And I would just draw the committee's attention to certainly our College of Scotland submission and the Funding Council submission around the Gender Action Plan, because I think the five key elements that are in there are could be used holistically right across. So if I look at things you talked about, influencing the influencers, you're talking about parents, teachers, staff who, you know, in colleges, schools and universities, employers have got a big part to play in this, current students. And then just having ambassadors. So, for example, there was you have the World Skills, which is a competition for schools. And in there we had a female who had a construction, they get a medallion of excellence. So you deliberately take something that you don't expect to see because we're culturally biased. So when a female does particularly well, it's about promoting that, and it's raising awareness to say this, you can do this. It's just perhaps you've just been ingrained to believe that you can't. I think a lot of it is absolutely right through our whole society, and I just don't think that we're aware of it as much. I just don't think we think about it until you do something like this and you realise just how ingrained it is.
Okay, thanks.
Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, convener. I'm just wondering what views the panel have on the kind of initiatives that the Scottish Government has taken, is taking around, for example, Fair Work and the Scottish Business Pledge, that include elements of closing the gender pay gap, but perhaps not as robustly as it might. We've had evidence from Engender Scotland saying that the questions around gender balance and diversity in the Scottish Business Pledge are almost meaningless. And in your own evidence, Talat, you talk about the Scottish Business Pledge and the Fair Work Convention having the capacity to do a lot more than they do. Would anyone like to reflect on that?
Just give you a little bit more. I think the Scottish Business Pledge, whilst well-intentioned, it doesn't give businesses enough to work on. So I can only see it as an introduction to the topic. That's what the Scottish Business Pledge feels like. There is space for it to be bolder. The aspect that is about gender is about balancing the workforce, and then you sign up to it, you'll say you'll do something about it, but actually, are you asked for a strategy? Is there accountability as to what you're doing to create a balanced workforce? Is there monitoring and evaluation? Will anybody be checking in to check that actually what you have pledged you are doing, and actually asking the women with those employers, is that making any kind of difference? So whilst it can't be seen as anything more than a softer touch introduction, and there has to be a lot more bolder intervention if the business pledge is actually going to do what it intended to do. And I think what exists there are vague sign-ups. I think there needs to be targets. I think there needs to be specifics about the expectation from employers if they sign up to such a pledge.
So to be clear, are you suggesting that those bolder ambitions could be embedded within the Scottish Business Pledge?
They could be. As it stands, I don't have any evidence to be able to, and despite looking for it, to be able to point to say that Scottish Business Pledge has created a balanced, as going in the right direction to create a balanced workforce. And I don't know where the evidence would be coming from or how data collection is being carried out with the Scottish Business Pledge. If it's to be something that is an intervention that will create change, then it needs to be specific. I think it needs to be target-driven. I think it needs to be bolder, and it needs to have accountability and monitoring and evaluation as a core part of it.
Okay, just continuing this conversation, you also say in your evidence that there's space for the Fair Work Convention to have a bigger impact. We had Patricia Finlay last week, who, as I understand, is the academic advisor, I think, mm-hmm. to the Fair Work Convention, saying that it's a very prominent part of what we do.
In the same way as the Scottish Business Pledge, what we need, and I think Close the Gap and Engender in both of their responses said this, and we agree, is there needs to be a national strategy around how we tackle the pay gap. What we've talked about on this panel in every question is the complexity behind it, the fact that there needs to be interventions right across the pipeline. What is missing is whether you've got the Women in Work report, whether you've got the Fair Work Convention, whether you've got the Scottish Business Pledge, we have lots of interventions, but those are not necessarily coherent, they're not strategic, they don't encompass themselves in a way that employers can look at and know where to go for support and what change to make. So we completely back Close the Gap in Gender in calling for a strategy that brings these things together, that is coherent, specific and target-driven.
And in that strategy, do you think there's any role for further legislation, or is that something we should inquire
of elsewhere?
I think there could be a role for that. I think it's. I would refer to close the gap for advice on that rather than from myself.
Tanya Castell.
I mean, I would support what Talat said. I think it could go a lot further. I won't repeat what she said, but I wholeheartedly support that. I think, you know, and again, providing that rationale, what I said earlier, just about helping businesses understand that this ultimately is a benefit, that it's not a pain in the neck for them, that they will get some result out of it. It's not just about being fair. It's, you know, this ultimately is better for Scotland. And it just comes across too many times that people are not aware of that difference of getting that diversity of thought into organisations. So I think just emphasising and pushing that makes sense.
I would just add to that as well, the Gender Action Plan, which the Funding Council has just rolled out across colleges and universities, is embedded in their outcome agreements. So it's picking up all the points you make. It's a strategy, it's measurable, it's specific, and it's there to see, and that's absolutely what you need.
Just coming back to the point you made, Tanya, about the evidence for the benefits to the Scottish economy, to any economy of having greater diversity, and making employers aware of that. Is that kind of evidence in the kind of format that it would be easy to convince employers about, or is it too generic, too macro?
I mean, it's hard because clearly if you're talking about performance, there's clear evidence that diverse teams perform better, to have different perspectives, more creative, more innovative. If you're talking about actual businesses, so if we're talking about commercial organisations, the research shows that there is correlation. You cannot prove that it's because you've got more diverse teams at the top, that it's a direct connection, but there is a high correlation. And that's, I mean, there's been a lot of research done by McKinsey, Credit Suisse, that you get improved profitability if you have more diverse management teams and boards. So, I mean, that is relatively compelling. You just can't say absolutely, because there are two elements of it. One, you have a more diverse board, but actually are you saying something, going back to the points we've already been talking about the culture of an organisation that enables you to have a diverse board? And therefore, again, when we're talking about the gender pay gap, because you have a better culture, actually people want to stay. I mean, we were talking about that drop-off earlier at sort of 39. There is more research out there that shows that you get to a stage where women just quite often don't want to be there. They step out. I mean, you know, I guess I stepped out of my exec career, full-time exec career, in my 40s, because you just sort of say, well, actually, that's not the way I want to play the game. I don't want to work 24/7 and actually have that aggressive nature. And so there's two elements. You know, yes, it performs better, but that could be because the culture of the organisation is different, and therefore you get a better quality of organisation, better output.
In response to my question, you talked about the evidence relating to management and boards.
Yes.
I mean, that's a tiny fraction of the workforce. So if that's the most compelling evidence, that's not going to do much for...
Oh, no, it's not the most compelling. I mean, as I say, there is research that a diverse team will come up with better outcomes, but I'm talking about when you're trying to measure diversity of organisations, they've tended to focus on at the top. And I would argue that if you make it the whole organisation, then you're going to get even better performance. Because when you're trying to look at a compelling economic environment, you're having to look at the bottom line. And I guess a lot of the researchers focus on the board level, does that make a difference? But yeah, there is other research which is just saying, does a diverse team perform better? And that does exist.
I think Talat, Yaqoob and Katie Hutton wanted to come in on this.
Equate Scotland's work is all about putting forward that business case. So understanding that there is an equalities and social responsibility, because I wouldn't want it to be only on the business case. I think there needs to be a responsibility and a social act involved in this as well. So we talk about both sides when we talk to employers. And actually, most of the time, we're not talking about boards, because other organisations are doing that. We're talking about diversity in teams. And where it works especially well, just to give you an example, is when we're talking about diversity in technology and engineering, because you are creating things for a customer base that is more diverse than your team. Just an anecdote to explain this. Apple produced the health kit, which was an all-encompassing health check that looked after every part of your
your health and your body. When they produced it, it was an all-male team, and what they forgot was menstruation and reproductive checks. So they forgot that that existed, even though this is a whole health checking app. So when we talk about things like that, it becomes about reputation as well, and that created quite a lot of reputational damage. So we tend to pull out that example as often as we can. But in tech and engineering, it's very clear and easy to talk about the need for creativity and diverse minds when it is a diverse customer base.
Okay. Some of us may be sceptical about what use these apps are generally for health anyway, but yes. Katie Hutton.
One of the things that the Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory on Equalities has said that they will work with us on is exactly about selling the message in a believable way that will be accepted by colleges. We've run some things past them and they said, look, we'll work with you on actually how you know, providing that message in a thing that's meaningful to employers, kind of the stuff that Talat was talking about as well. So that will be part of the work of that group going forward.
And I think Bill Bowman and then Richard Leonard wanted to come in with brief supplementaries.
Thank you, Convener. Just to follow up on what Andy Whiteman and Tanya Castell were saying, you said there'd been research by McKinsey and Credit Suisse on diverse boards performing better. Have they actually identified these companies and we can see their... They are outperforming the markets, for example.
Well, so the Credit Suisse one, I'd have to go back and check the exact companies, whether they listed them. There was a 2012 report, and they looked at listed companies, so they were looking at the return on equity. The McKinsey report was, I think, 389 companies. I'm just trying to remember if they list them in the back. Certainly, they know who they are. So they're across the Latin America, US, UK, and Canada, I think it was.
But it would seem that if you have this...
that's only two.
...information, then why is that not sort of out in the market? Why are the fund managers not using this to improve the performance of their investments?
I'm not sure I want to go into the fund management space. There's a lot of debate on fund managers now. I mean, I think...
But is that not fundamental in of looking at the performance of a company?
It is one aspect. That's why Credit Suisse did it.
But it doesn't seem to bring it out into the...
Well, there are... Just two. I mean, there are a lot of different reports. Catalysts have issued reports. So quite a lot of people have tried to do that evidence-based to say what is the... they're having to do correlation because clearly there are multiple factors that impact the performance of an organisation and its profitability, of which that is just one. The way the McKinsey did it, and they actually looked at ethnic diversity and gender diversity, and it was within your sector, if you had a diverse management team / board, your return on equity improved by, I think it was roughly 10% if you had a gender diversity in the top quartile. Interestingly, for ethnic diversity, it was a 35% increase in return on equity.
I suppose my point is that doesn't seem to have stepped actually into the active investment management market.
I think some people are aware, but again, it is only one factor, right? So it's not the only factor that's going to promote performance because regulation changes, markets move, I don't know, commodity prices move. So I think there's more discussion. Probably, maybe it says something about the fund management industry. Possibly.
Perhaps we could come to, Talat, Yaqoob wanted to come in on that.
I just wanted to point out the fact that part of the reason why that perhaps isn't filtered down is a point that Jackie Bailey made about our economy being small and medium-sized employers, and all of this data is very large employers. And I think when we're talking about the business case and we're talking about diversity and what impact it has, what we need is reporting and analysis of smaller, more accessible employers and what impact diversity can make there. I think that would make our case a lot stronger, and I think that might be read by and taken on board by a lot more of employers, and it would make our job a lot easier. When I'm looking at the McKinsey report, it is very large employers. It is looking at where you can identify where a lot of work is already happening.
Right, Richard Leonard.
Thanks, Committee. It's just to go back to the point about the gender equality plan that was mentioned. I mean, and the five C's has come up quite a number of times in the evidence session. And my experience, and I'm sure lots of other people's experiences, in the public sector, quite often two of the five C's, cleaning and catering staff, are outsourced, and therefore don't always come within the scope of a proper gender pay evaluation. Is that the case with these gender equality plans, or is account taken of the fact that people might have different employers but are performing those kind of jobs?
So can I ask for clarification? Do you mean as in how can the public sector and government hold them to account because they are employed by somebody else?
Yeah, I mean, my view would be that a responsible a public sector organisation would include in those lower paid workers, albeit they may be employed by a different outside agency. Yeah. Is that what's happening here?
Well, I personally, I don't have that information with us, but I could certainly look at the college sector and see if that's how they calculate it. But I don't have that today.
Yes, perhaps that's a point for all of the panel members. If issues have been raised that you'd like to come back in writing on that you've not perhaps anticipated here or not had the detail to your fingertips, then please feel free to do that. And the committee may indeed write to you with a few additional questions, perhaps for clarification. So do feel free to respond.
I would just add to that, though, that something that's just recently been discussed with the colleges is around living wage accreditation, which has actually taken your point entirely about low-paid roles like catering and cleaning, and making sure that at the very least they're being paid the living wage. So that's something the college sector is actively pursuing around living wage accreditation.
Good.
Living wage accredited employer.
Okay. Right, well, may I thank all of the members of our panel. We're now coming to the end of this session, so thank you very much for coming in. And I'll now suspend the meeting to... Sorry, is there another... Was there another question that a committee member wished to ask? Gillian Martin.
Thank you, convener. I'm feeling a wee bit panicky there. We've mentioned talking about the business case around having more sort of gender equality throughout a lot of areas. One of the issues that I have found about with regard to STEM is that when you're getting more women into studying STEM at university and college and schools and whatever, but they are not staying in STEM jobs. So there's issues around the workplace. You know, highly qualified women fully intending to have their careers in STEM and dropping off. What do you see as being the issues there?
Okay. So according to the Tapping All Our Talents report by the Royal Society of Edinburgh, 73% of women who graduate with STEM subjects do not stay in the STEM industries in technical roles. That's a huge drop-off. That is... it has an impact on the creativity, on the investment in those young women as well, by universities and colleges. When we have done data collection from those very women, it's a range of things. One is the lack of part-time flexible work in those areas, in those industries. We work closely to help employers pursue flexible work and part-time work. It is a struggle. There's not enough quality part-time work in those sectors available. The second is something that is we refer to as microaggressions. So the everyday hostility of being the only woman in a male-dominated environment. And so, for example, what we'll hear are anecdotes from women about it being presumed that you're going to take the minutes in the meeting because you're the woman, that you're going to go and get the lunch, that you will presume that you will have caring responsibilities that you need to leave for, the drip, drip, drip effect of casual sexism and that impact, meaning that women leave that workplace. And what we, like I said, refer to as microaggressions. And then there's another part of it, which is about a lack of progression routes. So you stay in the sector for, say, 5 years, you notice those around you progressing and you aren't being given the challenging projects or the progression opportunities. So a lack of progression and promotion, a hostile work environment and microaggressions, and a lack of quality, flexible work in the sector.
And coming back to the business case, losing staff, losing good staff is bad for business.
Absolutely.
So... I mean, a message really, I suppose, that I'm interested to hear. Things like flexible working is not a cost to a business necessarily. Yep. It's a way of
retaining talent. Would you agree with that? And you'd want to say, I mean, Shona's mentioned around flexible working and job sharing and actually having those things in place as a norm.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's not just necessarily about having them in place, it's having a culture where they're acceptable and that people want to actually take them up. So you can have a very good policy, but if there is a culture in the workplace that people feel that they're not encouraged to do that, or if they do it, they'll be sort of marked out as somebody who's different, then the policies themselves are not good enough. So it's the culture in the workplace that's important rather than the policies that organisations have.
We have to take some positive action there to deliberately create joint roles. And I know the Funding Council submission, for example, talked about a joint director role for two females to share who perhaps had caring. So it is about deliberately doing things to get away from the issues around inflexible. So it's, as you say, it's not just about having a policy, it's about deliberately doing things that show that you're willing to be flexible around.
And presumably not saying that flexible women is just
no,
working
not
just
for women. No,
yeah.
I know. I'm sorry.
We'd help that culture as well.
Yeah.
That's one thing that we're very clear about in the university, that everything that we do benefits the whole university community. So it's not just women who have caring responsibilities. So we put in place lots of interventions that help both men and women and try and ensure that the culture supports family-friendly working across the piece and not just seen as a woman's thing.
Mm. And just come back, I will be very quick, convener. Come back to what Bill Bowman was saying about actual evidence for business performance. Is anyone aware of any evidence around the kind of maybe the unseen costs of having to recruit because you're losing people on businesses as a result of not having these policies in place?
So we are working with Skills Development Scotland to put together a best practice guide on these very issues for the tech industry, and I don't have it to hand, I'm afraid, but I will send it to you directly, which is about the cost of recruitment, training and getting somebody at the level of somebody who has been there for 2 years and left. So we've got that data, particularly for it's in reference to the tech industries, but I can send that on. Unfortunately, I don't have it with me, but I'll send that to you directly.
Thank you. Thanks.
Right. Thank you. Well, I will now suspend the meeting and we'll move to our next panel of witnesses. Thank you very much again. Well, welcome back to everyone to our second panel of witnesses. Good morning. Thank you very much for coming in to see the committee today. Now, in no particular order, we have with us today Tricia Nelson, who's a partner in EY, Debbie Crosbie, who is Chief Operating Officer and Executive Director in the Clydesdale Bank, Gillian McLellan, who is a partner in CMS Cameron McKenna LLP, and Debbie Miller, who is the Inclusion Manager at Royal Bank of Scotland. So welcome to all of our witnesses today. Thank you for coming in. And we'll start with a question from Bill Bowman.
Thank you, Convener. If any of you were here for the whole session, you'll know that we like to ask about the basis that we draw the statistics from, and whether you believe there is a defined set of agreed statistics, put my teeth in, on female economic activity in Scotland and the pay gap.
Tricia Nelson.
Start that one. I did listen to last session, so that was useful, but I do concur that when a lot of the data is based on full-time, permanent is not as inclusive as it could be. And I think I've yet to be confident there is a definitive body of data. However, I'm hopeful that that's what we're about to embark upon.
Yeah, I would concur. I think that the data question is very important, actually, and I think that the changes that are coming to pass offer a great opportunity to start. I think the more that organisations can be encouraged to provide data that can provide a baseline, the better. I think that it's really important that when companies publish data, they're forced to talk about the improvements that they'll make in data, and then I think it gets much less confusing about how different people tend to present different figures. And I think industry's got lots of experience of being forced to publish data in certain standards, and I don't think there's any reason why there shouldn't be a really good opportunity to standardise as much as we can. But for me, it's about improvement in the data, not just the publishing of it.
Just to add to that, if I can, one thing that we're often seeing in this subject is it can be death by statistics. So is there one set of conclusive data for Scotland that is comprehensive enough? I think the answer has to be no. I think the other thing, as Debbie has said, it's very important we have legislation coming in. It could be a turning point, but there's a huge amount of discretion for how people implement this legislation and how they report, and therefore guidance to give employers clarity so that there's a level playing field in how people report, and so you can actually carry out like-for-like comparisons. It's going to be incredibly important as a measure for comparison.
I agree. In terms of what we're going to see next April will be a start, and I think transparency is good, but I think the way in which we're being asked to report by legal entity will complicate it. So from an RBS perspective, for example, it'll be really difficult to define the kind of border, kind of Scotland and the rest of the UK, and indeed a global position. So I think it's a start, but I think there'll be more work will have to be done on the back of that to interpret the data.
Thank you. Then just a follow-up, we will probably be relying a lot on the Scottish Government statistics, but do the large consulting companies have their own sort of global databases that you might have some more information that might be useful to us?
I think you're looking at me there. certainly, I think the gender pay gap for us is an output. It is one measure in a much, much broader conversation. So when we look at our data, which we're happy to share with you, lift different lenses such as background, disability, education, LGBT, it's all really, really important. Gender pay is one part of that. And yes, there is a body of evidence. There's World Economic Forum research, our own Women Fast Forward campaigns. All that data we can happily provide afterwards as well. But I do think the broader discussion is a really important one. Gender is one aspect, and the gender pay gap, I believe, is an outcome. And I'd be happy to give evidence and talk about the things that can be done to avoid that gap in the first place.
Yeah, I agree. Again, I think there's a danger. You look at that in isolation. If we go back to why we started work on the gender pay gap, it was very much about or designed to improve the balance of women at the top. So if you start to look at all the various component parts alongside the data, I think that's where it becomes helpful and meaningful.
As important as the data is, I think that the commentary on people's commitment to improve is far more important, because I think lots of large organisations can use different methods to present data, no matter how clever the Scottish Government wants to get about how specific it will be. So I think forcing people to talk much more specifically about their action plans for improvement and tracking their commitments to improvement, for me, is really the nub of this issue.
Thank you. We'll move on to a question from Richard Leonard.
Yeah, and it's just to follow up those points. I mean, Debbie Miller, first of all, I mean, are you suggesting that the RBS will publish data for Scotland, data for the rest of the UK, or will he just produce one figure for the whole company?
So at the moment, we are working through an analysis, so we're well ahead of the curve. We've actually got a site of our first set of analysis, which is, I'm sure you'll appreciate, we'll have to share with our internal stakeholders first of all. But as per the guidelines, we're required to report by legal entities, which don't often correlate well to how our organisation is constructed, so things that will mean things to you and I in the public. So do we have the option to cut it in different ways? Yes. Will we do that? I think, you know, we'll wait until we've got our whole story and see what's the most meaningful to people out there. But to the point that was made earlier, it's the narrative that kind of supports that, that will enable us to do that and paint a very accurate picture, a very transparent picture, not just about what the gap tells us, but what we're doing to address it.
But that's going to, it's a point that's been made already, isn't it? Yeah. Even at this stage, it's important that we're going to have consistency of Absolutely. Presentation of those stats, or else it will be impossible to make any cross-corporate comparisons, which we really need to do. And can I ask Debbie Crosbie a more specific question as well? Because I visited the Clydesdale Bank a couple of months ago and met with both the senior managers, but also Unite the Union. And I was introduced to some what I thought was quite pioneering work, which the bank does with the trade union in reviewing its annual pay settlements and putting that through some kind of gender equality audit. Could you maybe share that with the committee, please?
Yeah, so we, before the legislation comes in, we've been committed to doing gender equality pay audits for some time, as you've outlined, and we do share that data with the union, and we share action plans with the union. So, you know, I'm very proud of the fact that we are proactive in that. Having said that, I think that in order to ensure that all organisations face into the issue in the same way, you know, I do come back to the point that if board directors have to commit personally to the commentary, I can assure you they'll be very much more interested in it than if it's happening at a lower level. So as proud as we are, I think we've made a very good start, and I would encourage all organisations to take those steps. I think that to get it on the agenda, you have to force accountability at the board, and you have to make sure that the board directors are committing to seeing that through in a meaningful fashion. And that's about actions that really count. They're not about actions that present statistics to present the organisation in a light that's convenient for whatever public face they want to present.
And could I just press you for just a bit more detail? Because as I understand it, this is built into the collective bargaining process with the trade union, isn't it?
So, yes. Yes. So when we go into our pay negotiations, it's absolutely part, and we are committed to being very transparent on that audit, the outcomes of the audit, and of course the actions to the audit.
Yeah.
Thank you. And Gillian Martin wanted to come in with a supplementary.
I'd like to supplement Richard's line of questioning, since you've mentioned what you're doing in this. What business benefits have you seen as a result of taking this action?
I think that's challenging to be very specific. I think that there's lots of studies, and a number of them have been referred to in the earlier session, that do suggest that when you treat people culturally, you know, it's an inclusion culture, you want to do the right things, you want to encourage talent, and you want great people to stay with you, then of course it's good for business. It's very difficult to draw a very specific correlation, and I think it really is important that organisations from the top right through the senior management believe in this, because there's plenty of studies that people can produce, you know, that can contradict evidence. But I think as one of the largest employers in Glasgow and one of the largest employers in Scotland, it's really important to have that inclusion and that cultural aspect's at the heart of what you do. And I was very interested in some of the questions about why it's not more prevalent discussion in fund managers. Actually, having just finished a round of investor meetings, I can tell you that more and more fund managers and analysts are interested in what the culture is in organisations, how inclusive the culture is. They are quite challenging on how diverse your board is, and they are asking a lot of questions, not just about gender diversity, about the skill sets, the experience and the capability of the management team. And that capability, I think, needs to be presented in the broader sense, thinking about diversity, experience and the culture that you're trying to promote in the organisation.
The interesting piece as is the investor. So we've continued to make progress in RBS. Now our pipeline's increased by 12% in the last couple of years. And whilst, you know, we're still dealing with a legacy situation in terms of us as an organisation, we are making money. But from an investor perspective, we had our first investor last year, Pax Elevate, purely on the basis of our gender work. And at the tail end of last year, we were approached by Bloomberg, so another kind of organisation who were, appealing to the investor market. So when you look at how they've actually kind of shared the evidence of what employers are doing, it's very much to attract potential investors. So it's something that we've kind of got on our radar now, very encouraged by Pax Elevate, but certainly by the end of this year, we'd like to see another investor sign up to us purely on the basis of the work we're doing, not just on gender, but on our wider kind of inclusion agenda.
Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much. I wanted to ask you about the Women in Finance Charter and whether you thought it would support the pay gap reduction.
So again, RBS were one of the early adopters of the Women in Finance Charter last year, and it was a very easy one for us to sign up to. We had targets in place, we've got an exec sponsor, and we are transparent about those targets. Again, going back to the point that was made earlier, I think it will help the gender pay gap, but the gender pay gap's, you know, an outcome of doing the right thing. So it's that compound and integrated approach around, you know, treating our people how we would want to be treated that will help address things like the pay gap, will help address kind of the STEM issue we were talking about earlier, will help address the better balance of kind of women at the top of the house. So I think it's that compound effort. So I think, yes, the transparency will help, but it won't be the only thing.
Do you think it's the charter's actually strong enough? Because one of the points that it asks companies to sign up is to have an intention to ensure senior team pay is linked to the gender diversity. So, I mean, is it strong enough? And if it isn't strong enough, given the importance of the finance sector to Scotland's economy, should we have a charter of our own?
I think it's something to think about. So again, our targets are linked to pay. So we have three people measures, and gender balance, the gender targets is one of those. So it does have a direct link to the pay of our CEO and direct scope board. I think you're right in terms of your observation. It was very... It was open to interpretation in terms of how people responded to that, and some organisations have chosen to kind of be very overt, others less. So it's something we've fed back. So I think it could help. So on a personal view, I think it could help, as long as it drives the right behaviours.
Just if I can add to that, I think one thing, so I don't speak from a particular financial services organisation, but we act for a lot of financial services organisations, so it's a taking a step back, is that the Charter has put this kind of in headlights. It's increased sort of focus on the issue, and that in itself has to be a good thing. Well, the Charter, yes, the language you could see is not the strongest, but those who have signed up to it, I do see are actually, generally speaking, doing more. So they are actually making the commitment. It's almost like this is the signal, this is the way we're moving forward. Then they put some resource on it and do something more concrete.
Have you any indication of what proportion of finance companies have actually signed up to it?
I couldn't give that statistic today. It will be available, but I couldn't give that statistic.
So I believe 71 firms have signed the charter to date, and Clydesdale Bank is going to join in the second. I mean, look, I think these things are positive. I think you have to be very careful that often, if they're not strong enough, they offer large organisations good things to talk about without actually really changing what they're doing. So... I would encourage anything that promotes awareness of the issue, but I think you have to be very careful that you allow
or you encourage people, if they sign up, it has to be a full commitment, and that commitment has to be earned, and it has to be monitored, and it has to be managed. Otherwise, you just allow firms to talk about things they're doing without really making a difference.
Yeah, if I could add to that, I think anything that makes the conversation more open, more transparent, more permissible, and encourages women and men to have the debate conversation, I think, is a really positive thing. I agree with Debbie in the sense that if the longer that we have soft measures that can just be good PR, that's not good. I think there's a very clear distinction between very specific, action-oriented with measurable outcomes that, you know, we can talk about today and going forward, versus PR, which says the right thing. And there's a lot of both of them. Yes. And I'd like to see us spend more time seeing the wood for the trees, if you like.
How would you strengthen it without discouraging companies to sign up to it?
Well, I think, and again, having listened to this morning's sessions, I think if you think about the questions on quotas and enforcement, I'm a change person by background. I think if you force something, you'll get a result, but it'll be short term. Mm. It won't change the DNA of who we are as a country and what we stand for. It won't change the way every man, woman, child, teacher, nursery caregiver addresses the challenges that I believe all formulate and result in a form of gender pay gap. I think the point I wanted to make was the difference earlier mentioned in his of equality of pay, which is legislative versus gender parity, in a much broader discussion. And I think that's something I would encourage the committee to be really, really clear on with everyone that we're talking to, because I'm constantly seeing confusion in the two. I'm not saying that one is completely dealt with by legislation, but they are quite different things.
I'd like to pick up that point. I think they're very important. I mean, I think that equality in pay can be dealt with much more straightforwardly than the former, and I think it's a bit like you have to make progress and lead with the things that you think are tangible. We'll start people thinking about things differently, and I've got quite a strong view that if you legislate strongly and you encourage people to think very carefully about the importance of equal pay in the sense of women being paid equally for similar roles, I think you begin to open a much more helpful, longer-term conversation about, I think, which is a much more complicated issue, about why women don't have the same level of ambition to find themselves in more senior roles down the line. And I think structuring the conversation almost to deal with some of those more immediate issues may help the traction on the much more complicated issue.
Perhaps I could ask, you're talking about women in more senior roles, but how do your companies approach, or your organisations or firms approach your whole approach to business? So, for example, taking as an example, we have two representatives from two of the major banks. And if we think in terms of local bank closures and centralisation of banking services in terms of the physical location of the workforce, which may be a decision taken for business reasons, but what thought does a bank put into the consequences for its workforce, the accessibility to jobs of women and indeed men as a result of these business decisions? And so we're talking more about perhaps employees not at the top of the corporate structure, but the employees in other roles.
I think it's a really good point in terms of it's not just about the women at the top, it's about the full organisation. Certainly within, and I think the other point is it's not about fixing the women, because that's a debate that we hear time and time again around what are we doing to fix the women. It's not, it's about fixing society, it's about fixing the culture. Within RBS we have an organisational wide gender plan, which looks at all of our kind of processes and practices, so everything from organisational design through to kind of leadership development, through to engagement, reward, etc. So to answer your question around job closures, branch closures, for example, as part of our organisational design test, we do have a question in there around how has this positively impacted your gender balance. So it's something that's part of everything that we do, everything that our leaders do in terms of making decisions. We have governance in place in terms of resourcing, for example, to ensure we have females in shortlists and interview panels. So it's threaded through all our kind of people kind of processes, and it's led from the top, led and role modelled from the top down, but all the way through the organisation.
We have far more women in junior positions than we do, you'll be surprised to hear,
men, and right throughout, when you examine role profiles, the more senior roles, you will not be surprised to hear, the fewer women we have. Regardless of the person's gender, whenever we are involved in job losses, we go through, as you would expect, a very considered and structured process to make sure whether it's a male or a female, we offer people as best we can opportunities regardless of their location. I think the bank is trying very hard to make sure that we do promote women through the ranks, and it is very difficult. Like everybody else in the first evidence session, we are very challenged by getting women through those more junior roles, middle management roles, senior management roles onto the board, and we've put a lot of effort into it. I mean, I think it's a very complex issue, and I think it's very difficult. We do offer flexible working. I'm a great example of someone who, I'm a main board director of the bank. I spent 5 years of my career in the bank. I think I was the first executive to work part-time, and I worked part-time in a real job. I ran IT when I worked part-time. So I think the bank was incredibly forward-thinking and supportive of allowing me to do that. But the reality is it's very challenging for people, and offering flexible policies is very, very different from creating a culture where people feel truly they're supported and able to take those opportunities up. And I think that's really important for large organisations. It's not just about the policy, it's about enabling people to feel able to work in that environment.
Yes, I was perhaps more interested in the structuring of the business and how that affects people's ability to partake in the jobs available. Sorry, Tricia Nelson wanted to come in.
No, sorry, it was building on that point rather than your specific question, but I think the flexible working one maybe covers both in a sense. So I think going back to the fact we're now going to measure the gender pay gap, which is an outcome, and it will be a point in time when there'll be forced reporting, so that will be one degree of, I guess, visibility. We've been tackling this in EY for a number of years now, and a number of the campaigns and positive interventions around moving women through their careers from when they join us, from what used to just be graduates but now school leavers and apprentices, all the way through. Flexibility, again, can be one of these PR campaigns. But to really bring that to life, 84% of our staff surveyed recently work flexibly. So, and that ranges vastly from feeling empowered and feeling like you have the right and ability to be able to do your job the way that you feel it can be done. But in a framework where you're supported, you are progressed, whether that be in a client-facing world such as my own, where you're having those conversations with other peers and other organisations. So I think gone are the days where it's about physical recognition of a coat in the back of the chair and being in an office environment. And I've seen my world change vastly in the last 6 years in that respect. You look at technology, Convener, you've mentioned yourself, the introduction of internet, mobile working. I think the last question starts to hint at that, which is business is changing shape all over the world and within Scotland. We have to respond to that. We have to respond to that with flexible working policies that actually work, that I have the same challenges as many of the witnesses gave this morning around that drop-off at particular ages and particular seniority. Specific campaigns targeted at that. I'll give you an example. Last September, we launched a campaign called Reconnect, specifically targeted at women, professional women who had taken a career break of between 2 and 10 years. That is a really daunting prospect if you have, and I'm a mum, so I can speak from first-hand experience, taken a gap, and then you're looking to re-enter the professional workspace that you were in prior to either having a family or having a career break for a number of different reasons. So there are very, very specific things that can be done that will result in your staff, your employees, feeling like they can work flexibly. And then I think organisationally, as Debbie Miller mentioned, it's the organisation's responsibility to structure those opportunities and possibilities around whatever the business needs to thrive and survive. Because if the business doesn't thrive and survive, then we're kind of heading to nothing.
I think the final build on that point was around flexible working versus agile working. So I think it's about, you know, I think a lot of people still think about flexible working as working part-time, whereas actually to help address when we're closing branches or relocating, etc., we've enabled over 65,000 people to work from another location. So it's having the technology, so that investment up front to have the technology to allow people to work in a different location. So when those unfortunate situations do arise where people are kind of looking at losing their jobs, it opens up far more opportunities regardless of gender, but allows them to look at other, you know, other opportunities that might not have been available before. So I think it's that broader kind of concept of agile working as opposed to what we've traditionally thought about as flexible working and enabling it.
Okay, thank you. I'll move on to John Mason.
Okay, thanks, convener.
I think following on from some of the things Gordon MacDonald was saying and focusing on the Women in Finance Charter, I mean, quite a lot of the discussion has been around, you know, we need to change the attitudes, we need to change the culture, all of that kind of thing, long term. And I totally get that. In the previous, this is similar to a question asked in the previous session, I mean, our own party, the SNP, and I think other parties are similar, you know, have kind of changed their attitude from saying, well, you know, some of the women have got to the top and therefore other women can. And then, but we've got stuck for a while, it seems. And so now we are saying, no, there will be quotas, there will be targets, there will be whatever. So around that area, I mean, my understanding is the Women in Finance Charter has a target of 30% of women in senior positions by 2021. And I suppose that immediately contrasts with the public sector that boards should have 50% women on the boards by 2020. So, I mean, should we be having targets at all? Or quotas, or what?
So I've gone through a whole, personally, a whole kind of range of emotions around targets versus quotas. We had an aspirational commitment in place a number of years ago, 2012, 2013, to get to 30%. And remember, 30% was chosen because it represents a tipping point of culture change, so some of the research that was talked about earlier. We actually made some progress and we actually moved to above 30% at an aggregate level. However, we wanted to make it more authentic and real for our organisation. So at the end of 2014, we put informal targets in place. So these targets are the ones that I mentioned earlier, linked to our executives' pay, which means that each part of our business has got to get to at least 30% by 2020 and then 50-50 by 2030. So do I agree with them? It's helped focus leaders on the size of the challenge and the quantum of change required. But actually, the shift in their numbers is down to actually us doing things differently. So the gender plan that I referred to earlier, where we have things in place all across the employee life cycle that is, I guess, helping our leaders do things differently and applying consequences where these things are not adhered to, I think it has helped. So I'm somebody who has moved from not particularly been bought into the whole targets to seeing it's actually made a difference. So I think the transparency, I think the focus has really, really helped.
Can I just clarify, when you say parts of the business, are you meaning like different kind of sectors, or are you meaning like at the junior level there'd be 50-50, at the middle level there'd be 50-50?
So as an organisation we're 50-50 overall, if we kind of do a kind of straight split down the middle, but as Debbie was talking about earlier, we've got a pyramid as in most organisations, the number of women kind of reduces. But when I was talking about the different component parts, we have kind of three different franchises within RBS. We've got our investment bank, we've got our retail bank, and we've got our kind of private bank. We've also got our different functions, so areas such as kind of HR, finance, etc. So each one of Exco has a target to get their part of the business to at least 30% by 2020. And the important point that we've done this year is that there is significant variance across our functions and franchises. So as you would imagine, we're really struggling in our investment bank, so not dissimilar to the STEM challenges we were talking about earlier. But then we've got areas such as HR who are, we've got the reverse challenge. So our HR Chief Operating Officer also has a target in place to increase the number of men in HR. So it's actually about applying that lens in a different way where we need to do that too.
Right. And would you do it with middle management as a kind of, you know, even though they're in different sectors, could you say that you would also be aiming to have them 50-50?
It will happen naturally through that kind of 50-50. Middle management are already kind of over 40%.
Right,
so
right.
By pulling through more into the senior levels, what we'll start to see is the triangle becoming a rectangle. So that will happen by default.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thank you. Don't know if anyone else wants to comment. Ms. Nelson.
I think as a woman, you don't ever want to think that you're in a position because you're a woman. You're the best person for the job. all of the evidence in my organisation looks at the things that we can do at every stage. So you may start off with 50-50 male-female graduate split, easy to measure, easier to encourage, and the drop-off happens for lots of different reasons as people's careers progress. We've publicly stated our ambitions around 30% of our partnership being female. That drives a behaviour, I do believe, but at every level underneath that is all of the things, all of the points in someone's career where you can make a decision for them. I think there needs to be a lens. Whether it's a target is a different conversation. But if I take that from recruitment through to performance ratings at the year end, treatment of women pre and past maternity leave, including women in promotion rounds while they're still on maternity leave. So I've got some very positive examples of how that can change not just the culture, but change the way other leaders behave and the decisions they make. Two examples being, two of the women in my team are HR business partners and they job share. I could have easily made a decision not to do that. So we encourage our leaders through inclusive leadership training to really put a spotlight on the decisions that they make where they've got a chance to set an example through role modelling or a very physical representation in roles such as that one. Including the conversation for women who go on maternity leave, which is where we have some evidence that drops off, that women are less likely to return and progress their professional careers. And I see that evidencing around about the senior manager or director level. Having the conversation with the women about what they're going to do when they come back before they go is a very physical stated objective. So that may sound really simplistic, but if you've, those of you around the table that have had a baby, you think you know what it's going to be like. You actually don't until you've joined that club. So you can have all these ideas about my world's not going to change, my career's not going to change, you might not want it to change, but until you're in that conversation, it's very different. So those are less about targets, but much more about making sure that every single woman who's in that situation, and actually taking that further to be to make the parenting debate gender neutral. So that includes the men in that conversation. Men who become fathers also go through that change. Now, shared parental leave is great progression. We're nowhere near where we want to be on that, but I think there are a number of different, when we say targets, we tend to think about quotas and boards. I'd like to see us talk about targets of retention, returning to work, people at certain age groups from lots of different backgrounds. I mean, but generally I'm up for it because it drives some change.
Just to move slightly on a different angle, I mean, that is all, you're part of a huge organisation and you've got people thinking about this and presumably you're thinking about it a lot of the time. Are there lessons, can smaller companies learn some of that or is it just impossible for them?
No, my background has mainly been in small, medium-sized companies before, and actually one of the things that attracted me to my organisation was some of the things I'm talking about, and what I've seen happen over the last 6 years has been a real groundswell of change in terms of the way people work, the way clients work with us. Clients are demanding this now. So our clients, I think there's a perception that an awful lot of organisations don't want to enter this discussion. I don't think that's true. I think most of the organisations that I work with look for suppliers, partners from every aspect of the economy to represent society. So that's one step in the right direction. In terms of small businesses, I would love us to see, mentioned Jackie Bailey earlier about the SME population within Scotland. I think we could do a lot of partnering together. I think we could learn some lessons from small organisations who I think sometimes are often more adept at informal flexible working. That has its own challenges. I'd like to see small businesses, and if we're talking 250 employees up, that doesn't really define small. That's quite large actually for me. There are a lot of small organisations underneath that that can either get help or be helpful, I think. But I do think that some of those cultural imperatives about inclusive, responsible leadership apply as much to a small company as a big company. Okay. I'd actually argue from my experience it's harder to implement in a big organisation than it is a small one.
Thanks very much. Thank you.
Gil Patterson.
Yes, it's a point that John Mason raised and Tricia Nelson had given part of an answer. And you said it was a drop-off when women were away having their baby. And I wondered what childcare would have in that regard when there's a progression. You know, there seems to be a drop-off and no progression. So how important is childcare to that, to impact on that?
Well, it's fundamental, but I think we can. The thing I've learned is you can't make somebody's decision for them. So what's right for one family unit no matter what the shape of that family unit. And remember, they won't just be traditional family units, now that we all know that here, won't be right for another. So I flexibly work, for example, I live in Glasgow and I travel. So that's up to me and my partner and our kids' environment to figure out what works for us. I think what's really, really important, though, what is available for people at different stages in their career and of a variety of backgrounds and income. And that I still see as a big challenge. You know, working in industry when I had my first child, my goodness, you look at how much it's going to cost for a start. So I think there's an awful lot more we could do from a policy and economic point of view to make it financially attractive to go back to work. So there is a reality where I know a lot of women who have been in this position, and they will have sat and done the numbers and gone, do you know what? You know, why would I bother? That's the culture we need to break. We need to attract people back into work by making sure. And I do believe in Scotland we're probably quite far behind some other European countries in this respect. But I would be very surprised if it didn't end up being a work stream of activity out of the gender pay gap reporting for Scotland.
I mean, I just like to pick up on that point because I think it's vital. I mean, I hear a lot of people tell me that women have made the choice not to come back to work. I mean, the reality of that situation is they don't believe they have any other viable choice because they're in a role that means that they're going to end up working incredibly long hours, stressing the family and upsetting the routine. But because of childcare costs, it doesn't, you know, it just doesn't make any sense. So I think that the more that can be done centrally to provide realistic options for parents. Nobody wants to feel that they're going to leave their child in a situation where they can't be all the things that a parent expects to be. And I think for far too many women, that choice is just too difficult, so they opt out.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Well, sorry, would you like to come in there?
So I think we can look more broadly, though, because I think we typically talk about or think about childcare, we think about the early years, and actually as a parent of two primary school-aged children, I think the challenges get harder in some ways. Mm-hmm. So there's something about that wraparound care because, you know, there are still a lot of employers who work 9 to 5 or who are customer-facing, but schools don't. So I think there's something there. But also to take the kind of whole kind of caring responsibility a bit further than just childcare because of the changing kind of demographics. We've got a lot of kind of men and women who are now looking after elderly kind of individuals who perhaps have kind of need full-time care, and I just don't think the support around there is strong enough, not just in Scotland but across the UK. So I think there's more consideration around what can we do to help people with caring responsibilities per se, but broader than just kind of preschool.
Mm. Also, just building on the comments, it does mean that people make decisions and there is an element of choice in it. We should make sure people have options and then make the right choice for them. But inevitably for some people that choice will be to take a step back, or that choice will be to take time out. And that's why the whole idea of returnships and things, you know, to bring people back in is so important. It's almost become sometimes a bit of a bad word to say that people make choices, but they do and they have to for different reasons. So it's not something I see as often that clients are implementing, but I think it's a fantastic idea. And we were talking about it, Trish, at your organisation.
I was just, you know, observing that there is actually almost a built-in barrier for women, because time served, for instance, that rewards are there because you've spent so many years within the business. It's like a natural thing that happens. So because women have got domestic expectations placed on them by society, that then there is a natural break there, and it's how to overcome that so that they progress when they enter back into to the work stream again.
If I may, I think you're absolutely right. So you've got a double whammy, really, haven't you? You've got the fact that in the first place, society and as a couple, maybe the partner or the mother in the family has chosen to take a different path. And then when she wants to return to the workplace, we know that working below skills level is an issue for women within certain years. And the older that woman gets, then the harder it is. And we will all know friends who have trained in a certain career, and then when the children come along, they go, do you know what, I'm not going to do that anymore. It just all feels too hard. And that's what the Reconnect programme I was talking about is designed around. Now, it's early days, but it's gone well. But something that specifically says it is okay. And I think in an earlier debate, it may have been last week's when I read some of the transcript, there are women who will put entrepreneurship or self-employed or MD of my own company on a career gap to kind of hide it. And we want to make it okay to have that conversation. It says you've taken a career gap, you now want to re-enter the workforce. We have to make that much more appealing for women to say, do you know, this is what I did and I had a great time, but I'm ready to now come back. Can you work with me to make it flexible enough that you get, that you're lucky enough to get my talent? And we've got to reverse the conversation.
Thanks. Thank you.
Dean Lockhart.
Thank you. Just following up on this point about the senior level of female staff who may not return or return to a different position after having a family. In the first session, I asked a question about some figures we've seen showing that the pay gap actually doesn't exist in the age bracket 30 to 39 based in Scotland, but it then reappears in the age bracket 40 to 49 at 8.8%. Anecdotally and based on your own internal numbers, is that something you see in your organisation, and are there other reasons in addition to women deciding to have a family and perhaps either not returning or returning at a different level in the organisation?
Is that due to full-time employees only?
It's pay gap for full-time earnings by age group.
And I think that's part of the issue. So hence the point earlier about the data.
Yeah.
If the data, and I've heard the argument whether we report mean or median, you know, if you go for median statistically, yes, it's robust, but you will miss the outliers. If you go only for full-time, you will only get full-time equivalent. You won't get the richness of the employee spectrum within Scotland. So I couldn't really comment as the answer, but I'd really love to see the data.
Yeah. I'm really surprised, because that doesn't resonate with me, and I suspect what you, by excluding people in that age bracket, you'll have a lot of mothers who've either gone part-time or they're returning, and I suspect if you included that, you would probably see a gender pay gap the same as you see other areas, I suspect. Yeah.
We're still very early days in terms of kind of interpreting the analysis as per the gender pay gap guidelines within our RBS, but again,
in the early statistics I've had in our organisation, and it is early, I wouldn't recognise that.
Okay.
If I may, the only other point I would say though is that there is evidence that a woman's career slows down when she does return. So that would be another factor I'd be very keen to look at, is that progression through. So they may come back on a working pattern that suits them, but their progression through then those next senior levels, we know is slower. That's what we're trying to speed up. Make it okay to have the conversation and actively target different groups of community. So.
And can I just follow up on that in terms of things that you see working for supporting women who do return after having a family to a full-time position? What have you found in terms of what's been successful in transitioning women back to either the same level or a similar level to where they were or would have been hadn't they taken a break?
Yeah, no, so it's a very good question. So I think there's a number of different campaigns which we will follow up in writing, give you the evidence on those. But if I pick a couple of examples, it's about the people that they're returning to work with. So again, we fixate an awful lot on the women themselves. And actually, this is a much broader conversation. So a woman coming back to work and progressing through a career that has active sponsorship, is working with men and women, because men are incredibly important in this debate, and them taking action around that person and making it okay to have the conversation around, what am I going to do next? I'm still ambitious, I'm back, I've got toddlers, or I've got parents I care for, is really, really fundamental, but it's cultural. So you can't go on a training programme and just change that overnight. I think the second part is that it's very specific things like Career Watch is a programme where every woman has a specific sponsor who doesn't normally work with her. So somebody who will come at that very objectively and who will challenge because they don't know the norms within that women's own working environment has proven to be really successful. I benefited from a lot of these activities myself over the last 5 years. I think another one is we look at the way we resource our client jobs. So if we have a client situation where it requires a team to go and do a job of, I don't know, 10, 15, 20, however many people, then making sure that the person responsible for compiling that team isn't just looking through one lens, but they're looking at BME, they're looking at diversity, they're looking at gender, they're looking at flexibility of working. Because there's such a lot of evidence that the higher performing teams are made up of it's not just, with all due respect, white men who have got degrees in accountancy or technology or whatever that make up that skills base, the team will work differently. So I think there are many different lenses, and you could definitely apply this to small organisations. John Masson's questions, in terms of what you can apply, any teaming situation needs to be rich to get the right outcome.
But I just build on that. I think sponsorship's incredibly important, and we should also remember that there are a number of women who don't have children or who have different experiences that also have unconscious bias, so this is not just about men. I think the second thing that I'd pull out is networking support for women is really important. A lot of women miss out on opportunities because they don't know they're available, because they don't have the same networks, they don't have the same opportunity to network because of caring responsibilities. So I see a number of examples where people become aware of opportunities, or they're introduced to people who can open doors for them that women, just because of their circumstances, don't have access to. So encouraging women to find ways to participate within their pattern that suits their family circumstance, I think is very important.
I was going to build on that was around, you know, there isn't a silver bullet, you know, it puts in place really good people management and having the systems and infrastructure around that. So for me, you wouldn't treat a woman any differently to anybody coming back after a period of leave, whether that be sick leave, kind of career break or maternity leave. And I think it's about maintaining that dialogue should the individual want that, because some people do want a break. It's about little things we've done in RBS is we're looking at simple things like helping people retain systems access, because we automatically switched off, and that doesn't work for everybody. Now, getting through regulators and such like has been quite a challenge, but it's little things like that, having that dialogue, providing kind of retraining, kind of, you know, whatever's right for that individual. But it's just good kind of people management. It's good people management and keeping these doors kind of open.
Okay, just a final point, sorry. I mean, it strikes me what you're talking about is leadership and is driven by culture, and you probably can't legislate for this.
I would disagree, because I think you can motivate a lot of behaviours. I mean, having been in business for a long time, if you push targets and you force people to perform against targets, you change behaviours. I think that's unfortunate, and I'd love us all to have a very nice conversation about, you know, encouraging and training and developing. You know, for me, unless you want the pay gender gap to exist in 20, 30 years from now, I think you're going to have to be much bolder and much more specific. And I think, you know, unfortunately, there is a bit of motivation required that may have to be not all about telling all the good stories. I think there's occasions where it has to be pointed out quite clearly where people aren't complying with commitments that they've made.
I think it's about the conversation you have around the target. So just imposing a target is just one sledgehammer, if you like. I think culturally we underestimate that we can have great people management, but actually it comes down to the individual. It really, really does. And I think if we have a combination of visibility of performance through a number of different lenses, of which gender pay gap is one, and then get underneath that, I think I agree, you have a movement, if you like. So has there been progress? Undoubtedly. Is there a huge way to go? Absolutely.
It's quite interesting that the regulations that will come in don't really have, one of the criticisms is they don't have teeth. There's not really a very easy enforcement mechanism. But I don't have exact data to hand, but I am sure that some of the countries that have got enforcement sanctions, quite significant financial penalties, to the likes of France, they haven't reduced their gender pay gap any faster. So I think there are parts you can legislate for, but it's a bit like everyone has said today in an earlier session, that's the output, and there's a much, much kind of broader base below that, be it culture, be it people management, which I think would be hard. Actually, how would you even start legislating for that? But there are elements of it you can pick out and build good practice around.
Thank you.
Well, may I ask, as a white man who doesn't have an accountancy degree, just looking at this from the point of view of, again, not the top levels of companies and large companies, but small organisations, small companies, you know, they've a shop that has 5 employees, a small firm with 12 employees, how are these firms meant to cope with the reality if one of the workforce is away on maternity or paternity leave? The work has to be done, they need to replace that. That's a cost, obviously. Is it realistic to expect these firms to comply with this sort of way of thinking? What is out there to support them? Or does this mean that we move to a society and set up where only very large companies are able to absorb these sorts of costs and deal with these sorts of issues by having programs to get people back into the workforce when they return? What is the position for the small firms, small companies?
I think you've got to be realistic about the level that you can legislate this at, and I think for a bank that supports, you know, many SMEs, they tell us that, you know, they find the burden of legislation very, very difficult to deal with. So I think, I don't know what the right number is, but I think you have to be pragmatic. I think what you should expect, though, is if you set cultural norms from very large organisations right down to a realistic level, then what you will hope is that with all of the other good work that was talked about today about proactive action, etc., over time, I think this becomes much more the way that we do business. And I think anything that can be encouraged to motivate SMEs to do that, I would welcome. But I think you have to be very pragmatic and realistic about the level you would legislate this to.
Okay.
I agree, but I think there's also a role that big employers can play in helping kind of change society and help kind of smaller businesses. So within RBS, we've got a couple of schemes that I'm happy to share some information on around helping women in enterprise and new entrepreneurs, and as well as helping them set up their business. We also offer out some kind of support around how they might want to run their business, which we touch on topics such as this. So I think there's an opportunity for us to help affect the culture in the way that we want it to be moving forward.
It would be anything that economically penalises a small organisation to follow legislation doesn't feel right. So I think there's something about the business community and their voice and what would work for them, because I do believe that most small organisations, including the size that you've given, 5 or 10, and startups, one, they want to comply, but if it feels overbearing at times and over costly, then it's a hindrance. But do they want an inclusive workforce? And often small startups and small organisations are really, really rich and diverse, because it's coming from ideas around kitchen tables or Dragon's Den type things. So the more we can do to encourage business in Scotland and not penalise them through policy, then I think that would be really, really welcome. And I think the large business community would be very up for helping in that discussion.
I think there is a communication piece, because any support that's given by Scottish Enterprise, by CBI, by any of the organisations about setting up, starting a business, they look at your accounting processes, they look at all your basics. This should be brought into that conversation at that stage, and it's really not. So I think I agree, it's a sledgehammer for a business that's already struggling with legislation and regulation, but there is a cultural piece just to think about it from the start.
Okay, thank you. On to a question from Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, convener. I want to ask the same question I asked the previous panel. We've talked about the Women in Finance Charter, and you've given us some thoughts about the validity of quotas and targets and strategy, etc. What the Scottish Government has been doing on this includes things like the Scottish Business Pledge, the Fair Work Convention. Have you any views as to how useful those are and whether they could improve? Certainly we've got evidence from Agenda that the pledge and the Scottish Business Pledge covering this is almost meaningless, and we have data problems with the National Performance Framework, which still uses median full-time wages.
I would echo one of the comments made in the earlier session that the various initiatives, it's not a coherent structure. And therefore it doesn't make a huge impact. And the only organisations we work with who give really much or pay much attention to the likes of the Scottish Business Pledge are perhaps those that are tendering for public sector work, and they want to be able to tick the box and say they've done it. But I wouldn't say, with certainly the client base we work with, it's had a huge impact as it currently stands.
I don't really have anything to add to that. I think that's fair.
I think there's something to be said for decluttering. Making it very easy to understand what campaigns have teeth and which ones are cosmetic. I think that would be my advice.
And the other thing to say about that is that's not to undo the good work that's been done in each of these areas. So I've been to sessions where I'm hearing fantastic stuff that's happening in the Fair Work Convention, the Scottish Business Pledge. Everyone's doing an awful lot of work. They're just not doing it in a coordinated way. And that is an issue, it's going slightly off topic here, but
If you're aware of the organisation GEL, which is Glasgow Economic Leadership, they're doing huge amounts of sort of analysis. So why is there a gender pay gap? Why are women coming into financial services and they're leaving, or why are they not coming in? And then if you go to the likes of SFE, they're doing a whole lot of things. There's a whole lot of organisations doing a whole lot of work. And sometimes you just wish somebody would join the dots and stop the duplication.
Thank you. It's very clear.
And Ash Denham.
So obviously we know that financial services is a really high pay sector, so there's good opportunities there for women, but it's got obviously problems with its pay gap, and it's one of the widest ones from the information that we were given today. So if you're here in the earlier session, you'll have heard we were talking about workplace culture and the leaky pipeline and all that type of thing, and unconscious bias, microaggression, all these things were coming out in the earlier session. And a result of that is maybe that women in these industries are maybe clustered into certain roles, often at the bottom, maybe into more administrative type roles. So I suppose in that way, then they're missing out on, or they're not able to progress up the company. So they're missing out on the progression. They may be missing out on training opportunities and so on. So in some of the evidence that we've had in the written submissions, one of the organizations talked about this idea of having like a champion for this idea of trying to get women to progress up through the organisation at a very senior level, maybe somebody on the board. So I'm wondering if you could give me some idea of whether you think that's something that's maybe happening in your organisation. And the idea is this champion, I suppose, drives the culture down the organisation and maybe is responsible for maybe bringing in these sort of specific measurable programmes that we've talked about earlier to try and get change.
A CEO who leads a gender agenda, and say maybe have somebody who leads an ethnicity or LGBT or disability agenda. So they all sit at our bank exco level, very transparent in their actions. So these individuals would be responsible for kind of helping develop the plan or strategy, but also for its interpretation in the various parts of our business. So that will include helping pull through, but also the things that you talked about earlier, Tricia, around it's about affecting every part of our kind of processes. So anything that touches on people, it's not just about the focusing on development programmes to move people up. It's about that culture, that attitudinal piece. So we find having a sponsor helps. It gives it weight. People listen because it's a senior in the organisation. But again, it's one of a number of things. Having him in isolation, he happens to be white male, but having him in isolation wouldn't shift the dial. Again, I go back to that point I made earlier around it's that compound approach that's really important.
I think we also in the bank's board have very similar arrangements. I actually think that there's been a lot of very good work done at the board level. The problem is that for the large majority of people, it's almost unattainable. There's been some good progress in non-executive director appointments. You know, somebody referred earlier to the FTSE 100. But this is really about, yes, having sponsorship at the senior level, but it's about going into the organisation and enabling some very practical changes that allow people to make different choices. Going back to what I said earlier, I mean, most women don't decide they don't want promoted. They just can't get themselves into a position where they see it as achievable. They feel that it becomes too difficult. And, you know, I've got a daughter, I've worked part-time, I'm on the main board of a bank. It's incredibly difficult, and a lot of these roles demand a level of travelling, a level of hour working, and a level of just general disruption to your family life that is very, very difficult to maintain. So those choices are real for a lot of people. So very supportive of external board level sponsorship, but if that's not followed through with some very practical enabling strategies that really make a difference to the middle management layer and the team leader layer, then I think that, you know, it almost worsens the problem, because the organisation feels good about, you know, this sort of high level strategy, but it's not meaningful in the way it's followed through. So that for me is very, very important.
I would add to that I would call that activation. So we have a very active chairman, managing partner in the UK. It's not just him, though. I think that's the point. Without substance below it, people see through that. Clients see through it. You see through it. Employees see through it. So that's at one end of the scale. But what you're absolutely spot on about is that senior sponsorship and visible leadership. And without that, and without it just being one man or woman, it has to be across the board. I think the committee was also interested in global examples. I think I see very rich ideas from lots of other countries. Our own global chairman actions this talks about, his daughters talks about. So that role modelling is very, very evident. And I think the more, we can't do enough of that. But it has to be real and it has to be authentic or people see through it. And then those programmes that can be targeted, and there needs to be lots of them because it's not one programme, targeted at lots of different angles on the gender parity and outside of just gender in general. They all add up to a bit of a movement and there'll be a correlation. You won't quite be able to say it was one thing, but you'll be able to say there was a movement in the right direction. I think that's a positive. My final example would be schools, back to education. We haven't really touched on that in this session, but I know you did this morning, but if I look at our graduates at intake, then that's one measure, and that's when I get them, or school leavers. What happens before then is fundamental in terms of their beliefs of what they can then do after that. So I would welcome business involvement in the education conversation around how, and again, it's not just about STEM, but in its broadest sense. I've got a daughter who's an S1 at the moment, and I'm horrified by some of her maths homework, you know, where the man gets paid more than the woman in the problem-solving test in S1. And she said, "Mummy, look at this. You're going to talk to these people about pay." And I said, "Yes, I am." And I said, "What did you say?" And she said, "We pointed it out." And, you know, there's an acceptance that that's what happens. So if there's one little change we can make, and change that worksheet. That's one, but it's one little thing, but it's all those really subtle messages from nursery up.
Yeah, so when you were, the panel were speaking earlier, you were sort of making this distinction between, I suppose, organisations that take on sort of PR or box-ticking type exercises where they can say, oh, we're thinking about this and we're talking about this, but nothing measurable is actually coming through. So a number of you have given examples of programmes or schemes that you're running within your organisations in order to try and improve these things. Have you got data on whether these programmes are working? Can you point to, you know, are you measuring it? Are you seeing success? Can you speak a bit about that?
Yeah, at a very high level, so yes, is the short answer. At a very high level, we measure the impact on our pipeline, our top three layers. Mm-hmm. So say over the last 2 years, we've got evidence of progress. Right. The other big measure for us is around engagement, employee engagement. So through our annual opinion survey, we measure leadership engagement and leadership index and employee engagement. And it was interesting because the bank clearly had another tough year last year, and inclusion was the only category in their engagement scores to have increased last year, and we're now kind of 10 points above the global financial services norms. So we have got some real tangible evidence of change. But I guess to Tricia's point earlier, you know, you can't direct or correlate that change to one thing we're doing. It's the total effort that we're doing to change your organisation. And I think the other important point for us, and I'm sure for the others as well, gender's just one part of inclusion. We've got equal focus on disability, equal focus on LGBT and our multicultural agenda. So I think it's important you look at that in its entirety. But yeah, we can break that down further if it's useful in terms of any other measures that we can share.
I mean, I think any large organisation will be able to trip out lots of examples of how brilliantly they're doing. I think at the end of the day, though, we still have a very large gender pay gap. And I think we need to get much more tough on the best. I think there's something about picking 5 or 6 meaningful points of data and tracking the improvements and holding people to account. And, you know, I'm sure RBS and I can equally trip out lots of great things, but you know, the results I think speak for themselves. And I think that, you know, the current trajectory shows, I think, was it another 50 years before we close it? I just don't think it's good enough.
No, it's not.
I think it's a good point. You know, whilst I'm talking about, your question was around, can we evidence that my answer was yes? Mm. Are we there? No, we're not. You know, so we're certainly not complacent about where we are, and we know we've got a long journey to go, but it's starting to track. It's just going to be a slow burn unless, you know, I mean, it's a concerted effort.
I think there's early evidence, but then it's, for me, it's about scale and consistency and breadth. Mm-hmm. So I think, yes, we can give you positive examples. They're still relatively early, but I think 5-6 years in terms of my experience with my organisation. But if I look at other businesses and clients in the UK, they will have similar data. So I do think there's a data set out there that would be very interesting to look at. Each individual campaign all correlates, as I said, but I think it's the scalability now and the commitment from the organisations to see it through. Mm-hmm. That's what we've got to test. I think the advantage of publishing the gender pay gap in the manner in which you've set out in December will give, for the first time, a degree of consistency and a lens that you can look at mean or median, I think that will make the conversation much richer, definitely.
Okay, thank you.
Gillian Martin, did you have a question at this stage?
Yeah, I hate to drag it down into negativity because today you've pointed to so many positive examples of what your organisations are doing, and it's been really, really interesting to hear that. But it's been acknowledged that the financial services industry has got one of the highest gender pay gaps that's existing across all sectors. We heard last week that if you even looked at it based on bonuses, it's 83%, which is an absolutely shocking figure. I want to give you the opportunity to actually, on record, say why you think financial services has got such a large gender pay gap.
I don't sit here and represent the financial services sector of our business, but I think from my observations of what I can see in many industries, I think the examples will be similar. They may be accentuated, which I'll leave to the rest of the witnesses to evidence, but the same dynamics will be experienced in a large workforce. Almost the larger the workforce, then the bigger the problem seems to be sometimes. So I think from that perspective, and financial services, although it is a bigger gap, I think has the same challenges as any other organisation.
I've not got a huge amount to add to that. As I said, on a kind of personal basis, we were working through analysis, so I can't provide a view on where we are within RBS. But I think there's a kind of legacy or a historic issue around kind of, you know, lack of women in senior roles, which plays out in the gender pay gap, which is very different to what we were talking about earlier around occupational segregation. So can't point to any one thing and see why it's different.
Is there anything culturally about that industry that you think maybe is set up, has meant that gap is bigger than, say, you know, another sector like education?
I think it's more about the people who are in the roles. I don't think you have many financial services institutions who pay, you know, like for like roles. They don't pay differently based on gender. It's just the sort of glut, if you like, of male employees in the more senior roles, which
so it's
has
about
been
progression.
Yes, absolutely. And I think the progression figures are hugely interesting. So when the gender pay gap figures themselves are one indicator, but your progression figures of where people stall are very interesting as well as a separate measure. And we have also had clients in financial services working very hard to, for example, improve their gender diversity at board level and at senior level, and they are struggling to get the candidates. And they've had to go to specific agencies to try and get a wider pool of candidates, just rather than just fishing from the same pool. And that's an ongoing challenge. So I don't think there is one factor. There's just a huge historical number of factors that, yes, it needs addressed, absolutely, it's not acceptable, but it will take longer because of the number of factors.
So do you see that the issues that were discussed this morning's session around STEM being quite similar to what financial services have to put up with in terms of women actually looking at financial services as being an attractive career for them in the first instance?
It's a factor. I think it's one of the factors that will contribute to that.
I think if you look at the research that GEL have done, they've done research about women going in to study at university in financial services, or that type of qualification that might lend itself to financial services, and there's a far smaller percentage than you would expect then go on to go into financial services, and they're looking at it as, what is the issue here? There must be an image of our industry that is putting people off, so I think that it's definitely a factor there.
I mean, my experience is that the networks, the sponsorship and the culture that exist in a lot of financial services organisations make it very difficult for women when they come out of more junior roles to progress. There's some very practical issues. Most financial services organisations demand long hours, travelling, and it's just very difficult if you decide to have children when you step out to step back in. I think also there's quite a difference between retail banking culture and investment banking culture. When, you know, I'm always amazed, you know, as much as there's not many women in retail banking, there's hardly any women at all in investment banking. So I think that a lot of the things that you've talked about, encouraging role models, networking, sponsorship, and really encouraging people to be successful in that environment, is very, very important, because it's very lonely. I mean, I was listening to some of the evidence points this morning, and you know, one of the ladies talked to the fact that if you are the only woman in a lot of environments, it's challenging and it's lonely, and it sometimes can be very easy just to step away.
Okay. Thank you. Jackie Bailey.
Thank you.
Convener, we've obviously covered legislation, culture change, leadership. I want to touch briefly on incentives, because obviously the enterprise agencies do provide financial support for attracting, say, inward investment across a number of sectors, including the financial services sector. Do you think that investment support should include conditions to tackle gender pay gap?
Why not? I mean, I think the way that I would think about this problem is you should think about it. It should always address that issue unless there's a very good reason for it not. So my view would be, why not?
Never did hear that. And actually, it's quite interesting that you see some of the financial services organisations are now, they have it as part of their scorecard, that when you're being appraised as a senior executive and looking at, you know, what your salary increase will be, for example, they will look at what you've done to meet your targets in your area for gender diversity. So that principle must flow through.
Okay. Yeah, I would say that anything that makes the discussion broader and it's inclusive, I think that's part for me, provided it's not here's an incentive that's about getting more women into higher paid jobs. It can't be as blatant as that, would be my suggestion, but it's much more about the outcome and the business performance, because actually what we're really talking about here is the performance of the Scottish economy, the UK economy, business economy, and how we thrive. And I think it's very easy to lose sight of that. The whole point is, if we have more diverse teams, more women in different jobs and higher up grades at all levels of the organisation, and there's a degree of choice in all of that. Not every woman in my business, for example, wants to be a partner. You know, they need to get to where they want to get to and feel no barriers. So I think if we've got to keep looking through the economy and business lens, and therefore those incentives could be wrapped as an enabler to that rather than as a specific on its own. The other point I would say is the scorecarding one is a very important measure. So as an organisation, and we evidence this to clients as well, all of these measures I'm talking about are on our scorecards all the way through the senior levels in the organisation. I think that's really, really important. And that changes the tone of the conversation. So anything you can measure, incentivise, and targets with teeth, I think, was one of your points, Gillian.
Money, only around,
I guess the gender pay gap is one element of it, so it's gender parity per se, but I hear you in terms of the individual component parts. And I think it is absolutely right to wrap it as growing the Scottish economy, because the potential to grow the economy by closing the pay gap is substantial and something we should be striving for. One final question, Convener. A number of other witnesses have suggested that perhaps a national strategy would both give you the coordination you're after, but also bring a real focus to this area. Is that something you think would be helpful?
Yes, I think if you mean by a national strategy that it could also be a sort of 360-degree solution almost that starts with the education at very early stages, so it's entirely joined up. So it's not just about agencies being joined up, but the full process. I think that's how you will, the only way you will actually deliver the change long-term that we're trying to deliver.
Okay. Yeah, I would say that any stakeholder who has either an enabling a contribution they can make is responsible for some of the outcomes or will benefit. And that for me includes education all the way through to the large businesses in Scotland, an integrated conversation. And I'd go further than that and say it would be very easy for us to focus on, because gender gets press, it would be very easy for us to focus on that side of it. Keep going back to the economy, but I would love to see something coming out of the committee that says we're going to pull a cross-section of people together. And I know that the committee is about policy, regulation, education, business, and the shared accountability we've got. The point on that is, how do you align people around one purpose and one goal? And that's got to be back to the economy.
Thank you, Convener.
Right, thank you. May I ask, is it just about money? Would you agree it's not just about money in terms of making sure the numbers add up? And if I can give it an example, perhaps, to put that in context, employees or individuals working may actually want other things, not just necessarily financial recognition, but the possibility of flexible working hours, reduced roles at certain points in their career, and so forth and so on. An example in NHS Lothian, the GP practices being managed by partners, some of them are now managed, and then the GPs who work in those practices are on employee contracts rather than being partners in a practice, because they would prefer to be an employee. Now, whether male or female. And the reason for doing that may be they don't want to work the hours that might be required if they took up a partnership. So people take decisions for a lot of reasons or may want other things in money. So is it a question of just lining the numbers up, or is it important to look at all of the different aspects of the employment situation for the individuals?
There are two different examples, I think, in the that you've just outlined. One is a partnership model to a non-partnership one is probably not the best one I would choose. I would choose more, be careful that we don't trade flexibility for money. So I think we have to be very careful what that conversation is, but it's about that individual's choice and what they choose that they want to do, making sure they are fairly and equally rewarded for that. The example of the partnership one I completely understand, which is about that correlation that you mentioned between a senior level type role, but it wouldn't have to be a partnership, it would just be any role that somebody wants to take a different pace of life or a different decision about. If they're still doing the same role, then they should still be paid equally for that. But I think you're talking about different choices and how I run my life rather than trading money for something. I just think we have to be quite careful with the language that we use in that respect.
It goes back to the point that was made earlier, so I agree with what you've said. I also hear you in terms of that kind of total package. But I guess the gender pay gap is the outcome of us having less women in senior roles. It's not an equal pay issue. So it's quite different. So I can understand that debate as part of the equal pay. It's not, you know, it's not just about the kind of pounds and pence, it's about the total package. But I think there is still a gender pay gap to address, regardless of all those other things that are happening on the peripheral.
I think providing choices for people, whether they're male or female, is very important. And I think as a responsible employer, there's no question that's absolutely the right thing to do. But I think in the earlier session, one of the panel asked one of the members a question about, you know, you've got X number of women on this board, but the board that really matters, you hardly have any women. And I think one of the questions that this committee needs to think carefully about is, what outcome are we driving for here? Because if you truly want to change business, you have to have more women CEOs, more women in positions that really matter. And I think, there's a lot of great progress. The FTSE 250 have appointed several women in the last few years. I think they're nearly at 30%. Fantastic outcome on the surface. You dive beneath those figures, and what you realise that when you look at UK retail banking and the whole of the UK, there are three executive directors. Three, right? That's the difference between women on boards and non-executive positions that are important, and I think we should celebrate that success. But I don't think we should pretend that if you really want to drive change, you have to change business leadership. And changing business leadership is really putting women in places where they make the decisions that drive business from the top of the organisation right down, and that's CEO positions and executive director positions for me.
And in terms of the statistics, do we have to look at what additional hours to contracted hours people work for the amount of money that they're in fact earning?
Sorry, could you repeat that?
Well, I'm just thinking in many roles, people are contracted for a certain number of hours, but the reality is to get to a higher position or higher level, people often go above and beyond the call of duty or what by law, in terms of contract, they would be obliged to. And I'm just wondering, when looking at statistics, go back to the original question, perhaps as we conclude, is that something that needs to be looked at as well? Because, if people are not being rewarded for the additional hours, that's a factor in all of this, isn't it?
I don't feel equipped to comment for that, actually, until we see some of the data, I think. But I understand the sentiment of the question, which is, what's hidden? Mm-hmm. You know, what's hidden and what's overt.
I think it is a fair point that has to be considered, because we're not just looking at treating women fairly, we're looking at treating workplaces fairly. And that's what breeds resentment, if people feel they are being undervalued because they are working very hard. So I think that is a factor that has to be taken into account. Mm-hmm. But equally, sometimes females can't do these hours because of extra commitments. So somewhere it's very hard to give a yes or no answer to it. I think you have to look at it in the round.
Mm-hmm. Right. All right. Well, thank you very much to all of our guests, and I'll suspend the meeting now, move into private session. Thank you.